It's a July 4th holiday blowout. You want comedy? We have comedy. We have Joe DeVito, Aaron Berg, Dr. Jay Sutay, the hardest working pediatrician in comedy, plus Jackie the Joke Man Martling tells 20 of the greatest jokes that should never be told. He's on at the end of the show. We put Jackie on at the end of the show because nobody can follow the brilliant Jackie the Joke Man Martling. He's got 20 jokes. You will drive into a tree. Plus, David Itzkoff, the culture reporter for the New York Times, is back to talk about his brand new book. It's being called The Definitive Biography of Robin Williams. The name of the book is Robin. David Itzkoff joins us to remember Robin Williams. Professor Corey Brettschneider is author of The Oath and the Office, a guide to the Constitution for future presidents. He talks about the Muslim ban, Anthony Kennedy, and what constitutional levers are at the Democrats' disposal to fight off Trump and his reactionary brand of conservative judges. Pretty scary stuff. Howie Klein from Down With Tyranny has been warning us about Joe Crowley for months. Well, Joe Crowley is disappearing. He's a bag man for Wall Street, and Alexandria Cortez is replacing him. Howie Klein talks about how he personally delivered last week's upset in Queens. He kind of helped out. And can the Dems run on a platform of eliminating ICE? Elizabeth Warren is calling for the dismantling of ICE. Can the Dems win saying that? Can the Dems call themselves socialists? Howie Klein says yes. Plus, we also have Emil Guillermo. He's the host of the PETA Podcast, People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals. It's our July 4th holiday blowout. You're in traffic. You're on a plane or a train. We have it all today for you. It's 3 a.m. on July 3rd, 2018. I'm David Feldman. We have a lot of show, so let's get right to it.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. Friend me on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter. Do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. Phase one of the redesign is now finished. Check it out. Hit the contact button ever so gently and tell me what you think. We have phase two coming up when I can afford it, when I have the time. I'm answering all your emails, by the way. A lot of them got buried because of the redesign, but we found all the emails that were sent to me in the past month, and I've returned all your emails. I apologize for the delay, but there are only so many hours in a day. All my free time has been spent redesigning the website, which I hope you'll check out over at davidfeldmanshow.com. It's a great show. We have Joe DeVito, Aaron Berg, Dr. Jay Sutay, the hardest working pediatrician in comedy, Jackie the Joke Man Martling, David Itzkoff from the New York Times, Corey Brettschneider, the author of The Oath and the Office, a guide to the Constitution for future presidents, Howie Klein from Down With Tyranny, and Emil Guillermo, the host of the PETA podcast, People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals. I don't know what more I can do for you other than start the show.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
It's hard to believe, but it's been almost 4 years since comedian Robin Williams passed away. Robin, published by Henry Holt, is considered by many to be the definitive biography on Robin Williams. It's written by David Itzkoff, who is the cultural reporter for the New York Times. He joins us today from the New York Times newsroom. Welcome back.
Oh, sure. Thank you for having me again.
Yeah, it's a pleasure and an honor. Well, I just started reading your book, Robin. It's great.
Thank you.
Full disclosure, I started at the Holy City Zoo in San Francisco in the 80s.
Sure.
Robin kept that place going. And, you know, I'd go so far as to say there'd be no comedy scene in San Francisco had it not been for Robin Williams. I had a friend, Larry Brown, and we were utterly convinced that the only reason people were showing up at these comedy clubs was the hope that Robin would show up. You know, we couldn't believe that anybody would sit through our act. So I'm biased. I think that's true. I think most of...
I will say, I mean, I did hear that sort of anecdotally from people, that feeling of certainly, you know, in the post-boom period and in some of the leaner years, especially for live comedy at you know, at these clubs, that it, because, you know, Robin had the reputation of doing these surprise pop-ins, that was, if nothing else, that was people's incentive for going out sometimes, that you know, fingers crossed, maybe he'll show up at 1 or 2 a.m. And save the night.
And you couldn't bottle it. You had to be there. You had to see it. You couldn't explain it. Really was the hand of God coming down from Mount Olympus to show us how to do comedy. So I'm biased. I'm completely biased when it comes to Robin. He was my hero. To me, Robin, he's like Bobby Kennedy. For me, because I know Bobby Kennedy was flawed, but the idea of the man was more important than who he really was. So let's talk about the idea of Robin. Did Robin Williams invent himself, or did he burst upon the scene fully formed?
Well, I think people have that impression of him because probably the large part of his fan base or his audience discovered him very quickly, that Mork and Mindy in particular was such a huge success and so quickly, and because for a lot of people that was their first exposure to him, that it did sort of seem like, okay, one day he didn't exist and then the next day he did. But from your own experience, you know, certainly he had been working the comedy clubs for a few years prior to that, and he'd been studying as an actor, a true classically trained actor, stage actor, for many years prior to that. He had his 3 years at Juilliard and a few years at the College of Moran and even a year at Claremont College in Los Angeles prior to that. You know, he was somebody who certainly had an interest in comedy and had sort of heroes and inspirations of his own, most certainly Jonathan Winters, you know, being, I think, the most prominent of them. So these kinds of things were all in his mind, and this is all work that he had put in, you know, before his breakthrough.
Why Robin, of all the cultural icons out there, why did you choose to immerse yourself in his life for, I would think, years, right? It takes years to write a book like this.
Yeah, it was a just about four years from start to finish working on the book. I mean, I was very fortunate that, you know, just in my capacity as a reporter at the Times, that I had written about him on a few occasions. You know, most substantially, there was a piece that I had done a few years ago when he was on what would basically be his last comedy tour, when he was going out with Weapons of Self-Destruction, that he had let me come on the road with him for a few days during that. And this was at a point where, just, you know, prior to the tour, he'd had a lot of really difficult experiences, some misfortunes in the sense of, you know, he had had a relapse into alcoholism. He had gone to rehab to get clean. You know, he divorced his wife, Marcia, who was really instrumental in his life. And then in trying to start up the tour, then he started having these heart problems and had to have valve replacement surgery and spend months recovering from that. So all these things were just sort of, you know, in the mix and in the background, you know, as I was traveling with him and talking to him. And all those life experiences were part of his act. They were things that he would joke about on a nightly basis in his show, and they were things that he and I talked about quite a bit, and particularly his experience with drinking and sobriety and his thoughts about that. And it really struck me, because you don't often meet people, really in any walk of life, but certainly people who are considered celebrities or famous entertainers, who are that open about themselves and their own, you know, shortcomings and failings. You know, when you meet somebody who I think is that candid about themselves and that sort of on the table in that way, you just, it was really hard to, you don't forget about something like that.
So you were seduced by him?
I don't know if that's quite the word. He just was unlike anybody else, except, and this is something that other people have pointed out to me, and I think there's some truth to it. I mean, my father is also a recovered addict, and I think I saw certain, just, you know, similarities and just, again, that sort of relentless candor that both people have, that I think particularly once people get clean, there is a tendency to want to just set the record straight about themselves. They want to tell people who they used to be, who they are now. They want you to know how they've transgressed. And I maybe I didn't realize it at the time, but I think after the fact, it might have had something to do with why I was so sort of taken or, you know, interested in the person who behaved that way.
You wrote a book called Cocaine Son about your dad's addiction to cocaine. Robin struggled with cocaine addiction and alcoholism. I would think Robin was more of a alcoholic than a cocaine addict. I didn't know him well enough, but I would assume cocaine, that he didn't need cocaine. How did cocaine affect Robin?
I mean, at least by his description, it was not something that he utilized in performance. I know people sort of sometimes make the assumption that because he was so, you know, frantic and high energy on stage, that must have been the effect of the drugs. And his claim, and I think there's probably some truth to it, is that, you know, he didn't use drugs on stage. They sort of impeded his process. But I could also understand how, particularly somebody who was living in Hollywood at the time that he was, in the late 70s and early 80s, and you know, in an era before that kind of behavior was really stigmatized, and also somebody who was basically operating at the highest echelon of fame at the time and going to a lot of exclusive parties and hanging out with quote-unquote cool people, you know, cocaine was just everywhere in that atmosphere. And you know, he said that he rarely ever had to pay for it himself, that people would just end up offering it to him wherever he went. And there's probably a lot of truth to that. It doesn't forgive or excuse the behavior, but it certainly seems pretty ubiquitous in the world that he occupied.
So I'm going to assume you loved Robin. There are some people who don't. I'm always shocked by the people who don't love Robin. I love Robin. I think about him all the time. Yeah. Yeah. What do you owe the reader and what do you owe the subject? Now, I would assume with the New York Times, it's different. You owe the reader more than you owe the subject. But when you're writing a book, who do you feel more responsible to, Robin or the reader?
Yeah, I think it's an interesting question, and I don't think I would be able to, or would have been able to, undertake something like this if, you know, Robin wasn't so, you know, I think open about himself or candid about himself in terms of, you know, some of the things we were talking about previously. It would have been very difficult, let's say, to write a book about somebody who was, you know, an abuser of drugs and alcohol if he wasn't already telling people that that's what he had done, or somebody who had been unfaithful in previous marriages, for example, if he wasn't already candid about those things or hadn't already discussed them. So from my standpoint, I don't feel like I was uncovering, you know, some side of him or radically changing the way that people might think about him if they didn't already know his work or know his life. And I think, honestly, you know, I mean, I certainly don't make any bones in the book about, you know, being a fan and an admirer of his and somebody who, you know, tremendously enjoyed all the work that he did. And I think just as you tell the story of him, my feeling is that it all goes hand in hand, that as you learn about his life, you understand why his work and the roles that he chose were so important to him. And certainly as you understand the work, you understand why he made some of the decisions that he did. And even though those weren't always good decisions and often had very negative implications or effects on him, that you still, even when he's making those choices, you have empathy for him. I thought he was a tremendously empathetic person himself, somebody who cared about everyone, people that he met, even only fleetingly, he cared about deeply. And so in terms of what you owe him, I think you have to treat him with the same respect that he treated other people.
When you started the book, what did you want to find out, and did you find it out?
I just wanted to know as much about his life, really from start to finish, as I could. I mean, there were stories about him, either that, you know, by that point, he told in a kind of, almost like a shorthand, or had, I think, reduced to sound bites himself because he was so used to talking about them in interviews, or just, you know, he could give a short answer and know that somebody was not really going to follow up. So even the way that he would talk about his own parents and his father, who was the automotive executive, and his mother, who was the sort of Southern belle, and I had a sense that there was truth to that, that those were, that he was describing real people, and that that's who they were. But you never, I certainly never really saw their lives explored or unpacked, or even his own upbringing as a child. You always heard the sort of legends of, you know, these massive, you know, mansions that he grew up in, and even the just the fact that he came from a wealthy background as opposed to one of kind of deprivation and hardship that a lot of comedians have in common. Again, those were all things that I think either he or other people talked about glancingly, but that I had never really seen it explored at any length, and just to even delve into that.
Yeah, you really
that
did.
Part of his life.
Yeah, I was kind of shocked by the great wealth that he was born into, and as well as the history of alcoholism that that ran through his family. He was not ashamed of that wealth or the alcoholism. He didn't try to hide where he came from. Especially in a shame-based culture, that was surprising. Is that what made him sore that, you know, he always used to say, don't be afraid. But I think it was more about not feeling any shame. Was he a shameless man? I think he was.
That's an interesting way to look at it. I wouldn't necessarily say it was shame, but I think if you look at how he started out and how he evolved as a stand-up, certainly, you know, in the, you know, the earliest years of his act, there wasn't a lot of what you would call the personal, I think, in that, that a lot of it was sort of character-based. They were quick little bits, you know, just all roles that he invented for himself that he would kind of leap from. But they weren't, let's say, you know, monologues of sort of saying, here's something that happened to me recently in my life, or here's something, you know. And I do think that to a certain extent that came from, you know, having a life that in some ways he didn't necessarily feel was worthy of a stand-up routine, or that he could easily translate into a routine. And why, for example, he was always, you know, a lot of his friends like Billy Crystal were, you know, not just stand-up performers, but like Jews who were, you know, in some ways cultural underdogs, or why he was fascinated with Black people and Black culture, because that was a world that he didn't know. And that certainly is a world of, you know, again, that sort of underdog experience, or you know, people who can use the stage and turn their shortcomings and failings into a positive and use that as power on stage. He didn't have any of that. You know, he came, again, being a wealthy WASP, but doesn't, you know, is not immediately going to, you know, win you the sympathy of an audience or a crowd. And I think that's why, you know, a lot of the earliest bits were so character driven. It really takes a long time, I mean, years in terms of his evolution as a stand-up before he's finally kind of telling you stories from his own life.
How disciplined was he?
I think more than people realize, that you wouldn't necessarily suspect from how he performed. Certainly the big stand-up acts, the ones that became national tours and HBO specials, and in a lot of his film performances, the ones that seemed to call for a lot of on-the-spot improvisation, there was a lot of prep and homework that he did, where, you know, if you take a film like Good Morning Vietnam, for example, I mean, literally, as they're filming in Thailand, I mean, every night he's going back to his room and not only reading up on the sort of history and the pop culture of that era, but, you know, doing these kind of early, you know, just kind of working out his own riffs. And, you know, at that time, his wife, Marcia, who was then his assistant, is the one sort of writing everything down. And the two of them are looking at outlines and trying to shape those things into material that he can then perform the next day. So a lot of that is happening behind the scenes and off camera, so that by the time he is, you know, on set the next day, it looks like it's all sort of happening spontaneously and in real time.
He was ravenous in every sense of the word. Intellectually, did he have tutors? Was he studying? Was he an autodidact?
Yeah, certainly by later in life and, you know, post-college, you know, I mean, he had just a, you know, tremendous cultural and intellectual appetite and, you know, read pretty voraciously. Marcia was also, you know, a pretty extensive reader, and that's, I think, was a big connection for them. And, you know, he was well-educated, even though he didn't finish at Juilliard. I mean, the 3 years that he spent there, there were not just, you know, classroom and stage training, but textbook learning and reading mm-hmm. of plays and reading of material. So, I mean, he had a big, a foundation.
Were people coming in? I always fantasized that the greatest minds of the Bay Area were coming in on a daily basis and tutoring him on whatever subject he was curious about or when he was prepping a role. Was he taking courses? Was he being homeschooled, or was it all?
It depends on the role, but if you take a movie, let's say like Awakenings, where the character that he was playing was essentially based on Oliver Sacks, was kind of a Baudelaireized version of Sacks. I mean, he spent a lot of time with Sacks on his daily rounds at the hospital and with various kinds of patients, not just like the ones you see in the film, but other people that, you know, Sacks was treating, people who had Tourette syndrome and you know, other behavioral disorders, and, you know, really learning not only how to be that person, but to see, you know, what they did on a day-to-day basis. So I think, you know, where there were parts that he played that called for that, or that, you know, he felt, let's say, you know, a duty or an obligation to really understand that the world that person inhabited, he would make the effort to do it.
Mm-hmm. What biography did you use as the gold standard when you were when you were struggling? What biography did you want to write?
The one that I've really enjoyed and was fascinated by was a book called Becoming Richard Pryor by Scott Saul. You know, really told his origin story in a way that I had never seen before, and really, you know, went back to the very beginnings of Pryor as a person and his family. I mean, going all the way back to rural Peoria and you know, his extended family, learning who he was. Also, interestingly, you know, the book basically cuts off in about 1980 or 81, right when Pryor made Live at the Sunset Strip, and you mm-hmm. still, you know, it leaves out, let's say, maybe the last, you know, 14 or 15 years of his life, and yet you still feel like you got the whole story.
I want to end by asking you about the Holy City Zoo. The Holy City
sure.
Zoo on 5th and Clement Street.
Yeah.
My life began, that was my Ellis Island. I always ask my grandparents,
wow.
Where are you from? And they'd say Ellis uh-huh. Island. I said, no, but you know, I want to hear about Eastern. Wait, no, my life begins at Ellis Island, according to all four of my grandparents. America, Ellis Island, that's it. My Ellis Island is the Holy uh-huh. City Zoo. I walked in there in 1983.
Wow.
And became an American citizen. I came when Rebecca started putting me on there. I became an American, and I was healed, and I met my ex-wife there. I had my bachelor party there.
Wow.
I became a fully functioning American because of the Holy City Zoo. And Robin subsidized the Holy City Zoo, and he used to say, if I don't keep this place going, you guys are going to kill somebody. the anger and rage. So tell me what you know about the Holy Cities, and then we'll wrap it up.
Yeah, I don't think I could even begin to compete with what you just said.
I'm not competing. I'm just curious.
Yeah,
what is the perception?
Put my knowledge side to side with yours, because I never got to experience it that way. Everything that I know about it is either something that somebody else told me, or that I read about it, or a photograph or a video that I saw. I never got to be there either as a patron of the club or a performer or anything like that. But I love the aura of it, and there are just so few places like that. Certainly now, I mean, there isn't really, there is obviously still a stand-up scene and a circuit that performers can play, but there isn't anything that kind of has, I think, both the authenticity of it, the kind of the ruggedness of it, the crudeness of it. There isn't any place now that somebody could start out in is going to be more polished than that. And that's just sort of how things go. Even comedy has been practiced long enough that there is a more sort of, there are just more rules around it. And that place just seemed totally anarchic and without without rules and without any kind of regulations. And there's something really charming and romantic about that.
Yeah, I'll let you go. And this is great. But here's my thing about the Holy City Zoo. I could always tell the San Francisco comics who worked out at the Holy City Zoo because they knew how to work the room. There were about 12 nooks and crannies inside the Holy City Zoo. So you could never kill. You could never get the entire room going because there was the balcony, there was the bar, there was the section by the bathroom. There were 12 spots. And in order to even do remotely well, you had to work the entire room. And I think all the comics who came out of the Holy City Zoo paid attention to the entire room when they performed anywhere else. And there was a magical mirror there where you could just feel like you were the ugliest hermit, this troll. And you'd go and look at yourself in the mirror. And there was something, it was an enchanting mirror that said, I could subject the audience to this face. It's not that bad. It's
terrific.
Yeah. Well, I'm enjoying your book. David Itzkoff is the culture reporter for the New York Times. And his new book, Robin, is published by Henry Holt. It's a division of Macmillan Publishing, and it's a bestseller, and it's considered the definitive biography of Robin Williams. And he joined us today from the New York Times newsroom. What a thrill for me. Thank you.
My pleasure. Thank you. Take care.
Stay on the line for 1 second.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
Joe DeVito joins us from Queens. Hello, sir.
Hey, how are you, David?
Okay, so do you have a Mac?
I do, and it's currently in the process of shitting the bed.
Okay.
And, I brought it in to get looked at because it was acting weird. I have to say, if you're going to call yourself the Genius Bar, you got to raise your game a little bit. He told me he thinks the problem is that the battery is swelling and it's bulging and it's pushing against other components inside the computer. And I've never related to my Mac more.
Did he adjust the rabbit ears and kick the side?
Well, we moved some of the tinfoil around and it did nothing.
You want to know the dirty, dark secret about Macs? Because mine is at the shop right now.
Mm.
How old is your Mac?
2011. And I'm really turning into this old man thing of I expect everything from computers to underwear to never wear out.
Okay.
So what's wrong with yours?
It's the dirty, dark secret that Mac doesn't want you to know. Take everything on your computer that you need, put it on a hard drive or up in the cloud, take it to the app store, and say to them, reinstall the operating system, and you have a brand new computer. Did you know that?
I think I had them do that once before, but I don't know if that addresses my bulging battery issue.
It's free to go to the Genius Bar and have them reinstall the operating system. Reinstall the operating system once a year, and your Mac will last three times as long. It's like a brand new computer.
Yeah.
Unless there's something with up with your battery or the hard drive.
Well, I think part of the problem is that in between, I brought it there last week, and in between them sending me home saying it was fine, and now I have several hours of pornography I just recently installed on it. So now I want to get it up and running healthy enough just for me to delete all that pornography.
That's right. Well, speaking of pornography, who was Master?
As we do.
Who is Master Skip?
Master Skip is this Hollywood executive. His name is Skip Chasey. And you know what? Well, there's a lot to unpack in this story. This was he had like a little dungeon in his basement, and he was.
When you say Hollywood executive, he's not a Hollywood executive. He's a step lower than a Hollywood executive. He's an agent with William Morris Endeavor.
Oh, okay.
Skip Chasey.
Skip Chasey.
With William Morris Endeavor. He's somebody who gets you work. Skip Chasey is somebody who would be in the audience, say, at Caroline's looking for talent. He would be giving you career advice. He'd say, Joe, sign with William Morris Endeavor. We will take care of your career. We'll give you advice. We'll make sure the right people are seeing it, and we'll take 10%.
I would not follow his advice.
Why is that?
Because someone died in his little sex dungeon in a mummification ritual. Well,
mummification ritual, that's signing with William Morris.
Well, he wrapped this person who...
That's what they say. It's a wrap. You're with William
Morris. It's a wrap. Yeah. They slated him. That was it. Right. Can you slate a sherp? And I'm admitting this is in poor taste that a person died here. And not only that, but well, this person named Doran George was a dancer and a professor of dance, who I figured out who he looks like. This is what makes it even better. He looks like John Biner.
Oh, you're right.
Doesn't he?
Yeah.
And how ironic, his death was bizarre.
John Biner's still alive.
Well, not John Biner's death.
Oh, this Bizarre guy was the name of the show that John Biner used to do. Yes, that's right. But our listeners don't remember Bizarre and John Biner. Yeah, but he looks like John Biner. You're absolutely right. Without mummification glue on his face.
Pre saran wrap. So he was wrapped. Part of the ritual was he wrapped them in saran wrap and gaffer's tape. So on set, you may be the gaffer's wondering what happened to my tape. Not to mention what the key grip and best boy, how they were involved in this.
Sounds like Duran was the best boy.
Well, we cannot say that because Duran was a non-binary person.
Okay.
And his pronoun was they. And I believe legally making this now a double homicide.
Okay, I can't go there, but clever.
Well,
but I'm
not a homicide at all. It just is considered like a oops.
Master Skip.
If your name is Skip and you're a master, that's your opportunity to use a different name than Skip. You need to be Master Doomlord or Thundercock or whatever you want to go with, or Master Glad Rap or whatever the fuck you want to call yourself. But that's your chance to break away from the Skipness of your name.
So this is a bondage session where you're put into a dungeon, mm-hmm. and a UCLA professor agrees to have his body wrapped by a William Morris agent. And that is supposed to do what for you sexually?
Well, I think you're forgetting that he also had his penis in a little tiny cage.
Is that true?
He did. He did. And with the saran wrap, I don't know. You try to look on the bright side. You can say he died as he lived, microwave safe. You don't want to die wrapped in tinfoil. Yeah, so they were doing a little sex play. And Master Skip is involved with an organization called Play. People of Leather... something you, I don't know, it's just, you know, can't you just
you can't pass judgment.
No. I am judging.
No.
Oh, I'll judge the shit. if not now, when can I judge? If you have a dead John Biner wrapped in saran wrap and you work with William Morris, I think I've got some leeway here with the judging. Then they think there's not going to be any charges because it was consensual. And I guess that's the risk you take. I mean, what's the point of going through a mummification ritual if there's no risk?
The room in which he was found was replete with padded floor tiles, a metal cage, and a padded examination table. That is a BDSM style dungeon that Master Skip used. These are people who give career advice in show business.
Yeah, I think that explains a lot.
Yeah.
I think that it might explain why Big Bang Theory is still on the air. People are out of their minds.
People in the business who gravitate to show business are out of their minds unless they're actually in show business. There are people like Joe DeVito who can get up in front of an audience and make them laugh and drive home and say, this joke worked, that didn't work, I'll tighten this, I'll fix that. It's real heavy lifting. It's a real job.
Mm-hmm. Then, and they don't even know that my penis is in a cage. I keep it to myself.
Then there are the people who are... in show business 8 hours a day.
Yeah.
They go to an office. They wear a suit and tie. Mm-hmm. They're the respectable ones because they sit behind a desk and they have secretaries and people think they're normal. And they're the deviants. They're the ones who have an extra 8 hours a day to think about other things besides comedy. Like Master Skip. He has 8 hours a day to be somebody other than an agent. You're a comedian 24/7. Master Skip, he's taking 10% only 8 hours a day. The rest of the time is spent examining UCLA professors while wrapping them in gaffer's tape and mummifying them. How could that, I mean, how does that turn you on?
I just can't imagine going through all the trouble.
I know.
That's what surprises me. I mean, I'm sitting here in my messy apartment thinking if I wanted to have someone over for sex, I have to vacuum. Like that to me, and I haven't done it. I haven't done it. I don't sit here thinking, let me get my speculum ready. And
if Trump's next Supreme Court justice goes through, after sex, you're going to have to vacuum as well. Go ahead. Sorry.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I don't want to judge someone who wears a penis cage, but I just think I'm going to say I don't think it's fair to the Berg.
I hope he had newspaper.
He did the funny papers. So I think we can't stress it enough that if you are a representative from William Morris and you have a sex dungeon and you're saran wrapping a dance non-binary dance professor from UCLA with gaffers, I'm just saying be careful out there.
Yeah. I just want to know if he's looking for any new clients. You like Chinese food?
I do. I'm a fan.
You like Chinese food in Michigan. I can't think of a better place to get more authentic Chinese cuisine than at a suburb in Michigan.
Yeah, I put that right up there with some Cincinnati Thai in terms of authenticity.
In Mount Clemens, Michigan, a woman was ordering food at China One, and she ended up eating something that wasn't on the menu.
It was an off-menu item. It was actually attached to the owner of the restaurant. She was unhappy with her part of her order, and then on the way out, it was like a scuffle. She bit off part of the owner's ear, and the worst part was a half hour later. I'm not even going to complete that joke. I think you know where I'm coming from on that. Yeah. So I was reading that.
Hang on. You know what he said when she bit his ear?
What did he say?
No substitutions. I don't know. So she bit his ear off, and was she arrested?
Yeah, she was arrested, and I think she was also made to return the free can of soda that came with biting the ear. You can't have it both ways, folks.
And she returned the ear, but she slipped it underneath the guy's door.
So she's now
that's a
arrested.
New York. That's a New York joke. Yeah. Go ahead.
So she was arrested. And it turns out also when she went to pick up the Chinese food, she left her child home unattended. So that adds to the...
Really? I didn't see that part.
Yeah. Sounds like she's really got her act together. But you know what she didn't do was die in saran wrap. So she's still ahead of the game.
So she was arrested. When is her hearing?
Right, when's his hearing? You know what? Again, I don't want to judge. I think you have to say, is there a thing where you are put in a takeout container and not saran wrap? And that little wire over you, it's very erotic.
Yeah. Well,
I wish them a quick recovery over at China One. And I think we can safe to say that her Yelp review will be scathing. Scathing. You know, she said, I felt like they just don't listen to me over at that place.
Going from ears to, fecal bacteria in waters off three Brooklyn beaches. They're finding fecal bacteria
They are
in Brooklyn beaches, and they say that when you swim in Brooklyn, you should expect below 104 colony-forming units per 100 milliliters of water. And 104 colony-forming units, that's fancy for poo.
Yeah. And see, there you go. Colonialism strikes again. yeah, they said that they – it's very shocking that they tested the water. It was at three beaches. It was Manhattan Beach, Kitty Beach, and Schitt's Creek. Water at Schitt's Creek. Not good. Actually, the other beach was Kingsborough Community College Beach. And when I read that, I thought, community college, right? if you could get those bacteria numbers up, maybe you wouldn't be at a safety beach.
Every year, it says, 27 billion gallons of raw sewage and stormwater are dumped into the New York Harbor when storms cause the sewers to overflow. Mm. The city can't handle rain. 27 billion gallons of raw sewage. Now, when they say raw sewage,
yeah,
can't they at least cook it?
I prefer mine in a vinaigrette. I don't like it raw. Is that part of the raw foods movement, that everything's raw all the way through?
So when you go to Manhattan Beach, you're
you know how I like my raw sewage? I like it in some Saran wrap. It's fresher.
You're basically swimming in toilet water.
Yeah.
All right.
I heard they ran some more tests, and they found that on Staten Island there actually was water in their feces.
Why would anybody go into the ocean knowing this now?
Yeah, I don't care how hot it. Well, this is, I guess you have to make some compromises with the real world, because anytime you enter a body of water, I mean, it pretty much is filled with, it's not like the fish and so forth step out to relieve themselves. So you're in a fish toilet, and now you're in a human. So the world is a giant toilet.
Yeah, man. Brian Wilson wrote about that. Poop John B.
And he was bedridden for 5 years after that.
It's a disgusting world. Winston Churchill.
Yes.
They think he was molested as a schoolboy, as a child. Yeah. Then again, he looked like a child all his life, so it may have happened when he was 70. A peer who's written four novels about Churchill says he had a difficult childhood, an impossible childhood. He was neglected, and he was abused physically, emotionally, and sexually, too. Does that give us insight into Churchill?
At best, you can say this, the idea that you could beat the shit out of children, mixed results.
Mm-hmm.
Because you have someone like Churchill who went on to be a great statesman and, of course, a pivotal figure in history, and then you have people who do that without being beaten within an inch of their life. I'm starting to think the beating of the child is removed from any sort of outcome you're expecting. I think it's just something that the people who do it enjoy doing.
He was sent off to a private school or a public school, St. George's in Ascot, run by Reverend Sned Kinserly,
who has about five Y's in his name, which are, I think, is a bad sign.
And Winston was like 6 years old. He stole a pocketful of sugar.
Very Oliver Twist.
He was taken to Reverend Sned Kinserly's office.
Yeah.
And he was put on Reverend Kinserly's lap. And he whipped out a switch and beat the crap out of Churchill. Blood was coming out of everywhere.
Yeah, it's awful. And then, isn't it amazing that that was considered part of the educational process? Was that, well, they give you a tour of the school. They say, well, we're putting in a swimming pool, and here's our switch grove. You select a fresh branch to beat your child. People thought, oh, wow, it's very exclusive.
Well, it goes back to the BDSM, the story of the British professor who came to UCLA and then needed Master Skip. Doesn't this say that there's some kind of trauma that happens to British kids at a boarding school and they have to relive it over and over again? Isn't that the story?
Well, that's what they get for wearing them sexy schoolboy outfits. He's strutting around wearing a blazer and short pants. Come on. I was lucky in that. I went to public school, but my parents tell me what it was like going to Catholic school, where my mother told me that she went to school every day in fear because the Irish nuns couldn't wait to beat the shit out of little Celia Poli because her brothers were constantly getting in trouble. So whenever one of my uncles would get in trouble, they would be like, now we get a chance to beat up on the little guinea in the class. So, and this was how you learned. This was how...
But that then informs your sexuality, according to Jung. You have some kind of trauma as a child, and then you work it out in the bedroom.
Yeah, that stuff is really... I mean, yeah, that stuff is, goes down pretty deep, you know?
What's your childhood trauma, Joe DeVito?
No, whatever it is, I'm still living it. I haven't... Look, let me tell you, I'm I still can't get it right because I'm sitting here by myself, draped in wax paper, and it does nothing for me. Trying to get a Tupperware party off the ground. Tupperware party. Have I been in a coma for 40 years? What's with my references?
What are your plans for July 4th?
I'm actually going to be trying to run around the city doing some spots because I have that show at Gotham on Thursday.
What's your show at Gotham?
It's a 10 o'clock show. It's this they have a regular showcase, but it's going to be shown for people who it's a virtual reality thing. If you at home have a virtual reality experience, you have the Oculus headset and so forth, you can enjoy the show in three dimensions.
This is exciting. So you would watch it on Facebook, right?
I think you can do it on Facebook. Yeah. But if you want to watch it in person, I've got some comps. So if someone wants to contact me through joedevito.com, I can try and put them on the list.
Okay. Tomorrow is Wednesday. That would be July 4th.
Yes. No. Yeah, oh, yes, because this is gonna be posted on Tuesday.
Yeah. So what do you do for July 4th?
I'm kind of taking it off this year.
Are the clubs open?
Yeah, well, you know, in Times Square, the tourists are going to be running around, so... Yeah. I don't like to have very big plans for a holiday because I feel like it's always going to be a letdown. I don't know. Maybe I'll go hit the beach down Brooklyn way.
Shit's up.
Yeah, that's right. You see me surfing on a turd.
Wipe out.
What are your 4th of July plans? Patriotic, I'd assume.
Absolutely. I'm going to go to the Washington Mall and hear Wayne Newton sing. Wasn't there something during the Reagan administration where they decided the Beach Boys were too controversial to sing for July 4th? So they hired Wayne Newton?
That does sound familiar, where, you know... That tends to happen after you have someone who's slightly controversial and then the pendulum swings so far in the other direction. I think there was not too long ago after one of those correspondence dinners or something like that. I think it was after Colbert hosted and they got all puffy. I think the next year they had Rich Little.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, yeah. Who's waiting for that call?
Well, Joe DeVito, how do people follow you on Twitter?
At Joe DeVito Comedy on Twitter and Instagram. Okay. And my website is joedevito.com.
Andy Dick has been charged with sexual battery. Andy Dick is facing charges for allegedly groping a complete stranger on the streets of Los Angeles.
Oh, God.
You know why?
Why?
Because it was Tuesday.
Yeah, he's got some problems.
I'm surprised he hasn't been, yeah, well.
A street grope. Not even someone you know.
Yeah.
Not good.
Yeah, not a good guy. Did some things that is unforgivable. What were we talking about? Oh, so, and you're going to be at Gotham on Thursday. And any big gigs we should know about?
Oh, in 2 weeks, I'm going up to the Comedy Nest in Montreal. First time I've been there and haven't been back to Montreal in years. So that's going to be fun.
That's a fun room. During the festival, they turned that into a venue, right?
Yeah. Well, you know, you've got the big Montreal Just for Laughs festival. It's the best comedians in the world, and it's attended by a lot of industry, and I'm going to be there the week before it starts.
All right. Stay on the line, sir. Thank you.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
Let's go to South Windsor, Connecticut, where the hardest working pediatrician in comedy is standing by, Dr. Jay Sutay. It's hot outside, sir.
Oh, good God, is it? How you doing there, David?
I'm hot. I've been swimming all day. I'm at a friend's house. They have a pool, and I've gone swimming in the morning, in the afternoon, and I'm going to go swimming when the sun goes down. That's the only way to deal with it.
That's the dog, and I have been in the pool all day.
Swimming's the best exercise.
I'll tell you, for the dog it is. I mean, he sacks out like he's been in a marathon after a day of being in the pool. I mean, he doesn't swim. He floats in a raft, but he keeps his balance on that, and he's pretty athletic when it comes to that. But my girlfriend's dog will jump in the pool, you know, just belly flop in the pool, do some laps back and forth, and my idiot dog just looks at him floating around in the raft, you know?
Well, it turns out that we've been washing our hands wrong. I've been washing my hands for 5 years.
And only five.
For the past 5 years, I finally started washing my hands. And I'm doing it wrong?
There is a specific way of washing your hands, according to the government, which is now going to, you know, tell us how many scraps of toilet paper we're going to be able to use to wipe our ass. It's all going to be controlled now. So
this is a new study from the Department of Agriculture, and people are falling short of meeting the standards for acceptable hand washing set by the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention.
And this goes not only for, you know, people that are in the medical field, but this goes for, you know, if you're cutting up chicken or things like that, you really want to have your hands clean. This is what you got to do.
Now, you're a doctor.
Yeah.
How often do you wash your hands, and how long does it take you to feel like your hands are completely clean?
We have to wash our hands either for a full 60 seconds, or if we have hand sanitizer, we've got to use it twice and let it dry. So,
and your stethoscope is filthy, though. Your necktie is filthy,
I
right?
I never clean my stethoscope. I take shit from one kid's chest right to the next kid. It never gets washed.
And it makes them stronger.
Listen, it's all part of my business model. Now that they've taken away the filthy toys and filthy books in my exam rooms, I got to rely on the stethoscope and try to maybe get three or four kids with the same tongue depressed with that one, too. So.
Well, doctor, we have a lot of listeners who may not know how to wash their hands. Luckily, the Centers for Disease Control, they've issued a guide on how to wash your hands. So if you're listening, pay attention. This is an actual step-by-step guide issued by the CDC. Wet your hands with clean running water. That's a novel idea, clean running water.
Well, they're talking about Flint, so.
You have an option, warm or cold. You talk about the nanny state, doctor. They say you can choose warm or cold water.
That's right. Freedom. You have a choice. Yep, that's true.
They say turn off the tap and apply soap. Lather your hands by rubbing them together with the soap. Be sure to lather the back of your... Actually, you know what?
What's that?
I don't lather the back of my hands.
Oh, Jesus.
I'm a pig. Nobody ever taught me to... I never knew you had to lather the back of your hands.
Back of the hands, in between the fingers.
Really?
Yeah, you gotta really do it. I mean, that's usually why people, they get poison ivy. They don't get it on their the top of their hands or on their palm, but they get it between their fingers because we never clean between our fingers.
I always feel like I'm sinning when I wash my hands because I'm a chronic hand washer. So I feel like I'm doing something wrong by always washing. I'm always washing my hands.
See, mine is if I wash my hands 20 times a day, the Yankees win. So
it says wash under your nails between your fingers, and you should scrub your hands for at least 20 seconds.
Yep. Okay. Need a timer. I like this. Sing happy birthday or hum it to yourself twice.
Yeah, that's not unusual. To wash
your
hands.
I do that all the time when I wash my hands.
Mm-hmm. That's how you're going to get your medical license taken away. Somebody's going to see you humming happy birthday while washing your hands for 20 seconds, and they're going to say, we don't want this guy anywhere near our kids.
No, we're leaving now. We're leaving now. Get the infant carrier.
So it's hot. Sweating is good, right?
Well, you didn't get to the end of it. You got to rinse your hand under running water. I don't want to leave the people hanging.
I don't want to insult the stupidity of my audience.
I noticed they didn't tell you to turn the tap back on. I guess that is a given. All right. They told you to turn it off, but now you sing happy birthday twice, and they say rinse your hands well under clean running water, and yet they did not tell you to turn it back on. And at the end, when they say dry your hands using a clean towel or air dry them, they don't tell you to turn it off. Why did they tell us to turn it off at the very beginning? Because I don't. I'll let the water run. Fuck the environment. As long as my hands are clean.
I'm actually over at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. And there's a section called, when should you wash your hands?
I think I clicked on that, too. It's funny, isn't it?
Turns out you should wash your hands after using the toilet.
Really?
Uh-huh. After touching an animal or animal waste.
There you go.
After touching garbage.
Okay.
It doesn't say after shaking hands with an insurance salesman.
No, doesn't it? Or a lawyer.
Or a lawyer. Okay, this is important.
Well, that might fall under after touching garbage.
We need the Centers for Disease Control, saving lives and protecting people. Very good. Okay, so sweating is important. Your dog, how does your dog sweat?
I think through his tongue.
And he drools, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And it's like 98 degrees today.
It was 104 yesterday in Connecticut.
Underarm sweating is kind of embarrassing.
Yes.
There's a new treatment, you say, for underarm sweating. I thought there is it Botox? Does Botox?
Yeah, they use the Botox to zap the nerves that innervate the sweat glands, so that the sweat glands don't release the sweat. So that's what they've been using. Probably for about 15 years now.
And does my armpit look younger? The Botox, I would hope, would make. Because I'm always been ashamed of my saggy, wrinkly armpit.
Yeah, I'm more sad about my arm dangle, which is a little further down my upper extremity. But I think my armpits are pretty good shape, actually. I work them. I work them every day, exercise them, do a couple of bilabial fricatives there. Artificial fat under the arm.
They shoot your armpit with Botox to stop underarm sweating.
Right.
But what happens to the sweat? It's got to go somewhere.
It just doesn't get made.
But don't you need to sweat?
Well, you don't have to sweat in your armpits. You can let the heat out in other areas of your body. But if you're someone who gets big, huge rings of pit sweat on your nice clothes, there are a couple over the counter products. There's one called Drysol, which you could apply topically, which is just an antiperspirant. It works not as well as the Botox does. And this stuff the new stuff that they just approved sounds very promising for a lot of people who suffer from this. I believe it's called hypersiderosis.
Hypersiderosis.
Yeah.
Hypersiderosis. I've noticed, doctor, that.
Or hyperhidrosis.
When I work out, I can't stop sweating. Now, somebody said don't drink water after a workout. That way you won't sweat. But I'm telling you, I could take a cold shower, get out, and I'm still sweating.
If I don't get out of the shower with ice cold water, drop it on me, I'll start sweating again, too.
It takes me
amazing.
a full half hour to stop sweating after a workout.
Well, I'll tell you, some of those ball drying powders will work in your armpits too, like you know, the fresh balls and the chassis ball powder. For, you know, you could toss a little bit of that under your arms too. It probably works pretty good.
And what about getting your balls rotated every 10 years?
Isn't that in the warranty?
All right, I'm not going to talk about go violently. Was this a joke?
Shouldn't we say what the new CDC approved, David?
What did they approve?
They approved something called Qbrexa, which is a cloth that has a antiperspirant in it, and you just apply topically the cloth, and it will cut your armpit sweating down significantly. Supposed to hit pharmacies in October, and no word yet on how much it's going to cost for you to have dry pits, but research and development is working on it for you. So for approved for patients 9 years and older. Use the Botox for people with sweaty hands too, not just the armpit. If someone has like a wet fish kind of a handshake, Botox can decrease the sweating in the hand as well.
By attacking the armpit.
Yeah. Hitting the same nerves that innervate the sweat glands.
Right. I was told that a clammy handshake can be cured by Botox in the armpit.
Yep. Wow, you are correct, sir.
Why is it really? It's a nerve that causes the sweat?
Yeah, the autonomic nerve system that kind of runs in the background. You know, when you get hot, it tells your body to sweat to let the heat out. And it happens automatically, and in order to stop it, you have to, you know, kind of paralyze the nerves so they don't send the message to make sweat.
If it's 98 degrees, do you let your kid outside?
I had a call yesterday, actually. I was on call about a kid who played baseball from 8 a.m. to 1 o'clock yesterday afternoon, who probably had the beginning of heat stroke, a 9-year-old kid. So, you know, you got to do it in moderation. You got to make sure that you're drinking plenty. And if you start to feel sick, nauseous, you get a fever. I mean, the temperature with heat stroke, body temperature can go up to 104, 105 degrees.
And what is heat stroke?
It's basically what they call the body overheating. And it may or may not be due to dehydration. Sometimes dehydration can make it come on quicker, but heat stroke is usually just too much time in the sun and not taking enough fluids and overdoing it. So, you know, especially for young kids who, you know, don't drink as well as they should, that can happen. But, you know, sweating helps. And kids just run out of sweat with heat stroke too. Their skin gets red and dry, and they get muscle cramps, and they can vomit. This kid had actually vomited a couple times yesterday.
The beach is especially dangerous because the wind cools you off, so you're not aware of how strong the sun is, and then suddenly you can have heat stroke and not be aware of it. I think that's the most dangerous place on a hot day. Right.
Yeah, I agree with you. But you got the water right there, so use it.
Well, assuming it's not filled with toxic sewage.
We have Long Island Sound up our way, so we know what's in that.
All right.
But as a kid, my father used to have me go out clamming off of Stratford, Connecticut with him in this filthy Long Island Sound water, and then he would suck clams off the half shell. I'm surprised he doesn't have, you know, some kind of superpower now. Because of that,
there's a season for clams to kill, right? Do you want to kill somebody?
I think so. Let me tell you something. I would never eat clams either, not knowing what goes into the ocean.
Yeah. People go into the ocean.
That's right.
Unaccompanied parts of us go into the ocean. Well, before you go, let's tackle something that's kind of. I'm doing this because a listener says I should have Mark Crispin Miller on the show. And I wrote back and I said, I don't want to go down this rabbit hole because Mark Crispin Miller is a professor from NYU. And he believes that there's a cover up. The government is covering up the link between vaccines and autism. Bobby Kennedy Jr., I know, has seen the light and claims there's a link between autism and vaccines, I promised a listener, a loyal listener, that I would discuss Mark Crispin Miller, vaccines and autism. I said it's like Tower 7.
Right. Once he also is suspicious of that, too.
Yeah. I don't want to go down that path. I'm not qualified to discuss at what temperature steel burns and whether or not mercury should or should not be inside a vaccine. The people I trust, I mean, there are some issues where you have to surrender and say, okay, who are the smart people on this? Who do I trust? And
doesn't sound like he's one of them.
Well, what happened to, is it Dr. Bob? Somebody had their...
Yeah, he lost his, he's on probation now. He apparently, without having a two-year-old's medical records available to him, took the mother's word that the kid had some type of a adverse reaction to a vaccine. So he makes a living writing letters for parents in California, excusing them from their required vaccinations. Because after we had that measles outbreak in Disneyland out in California in 2015, California got very serious and they were not going to take ethical and religious exemptions anymore. They would only exempt children from vaccinations if they have a letter from a doctor. And he's basically the guy you go to get that letter. So
Dr. Bob Sears.
Yeah. And he apparently is on probation, meaning that he has to have somebody oversee him. He has to be monitored by another doctor. It limits his ability to practice. But, you know, you can't be writing out letters for people you talk to on the phone and haven't examined and haven't gotten copies of previous records. That's just bad medicine. And I think that's why he's on probation, was that he trusted the mother's words. And I think he even said that, you know, that it's my job to listen to patients and parents and believe what they say, you know. And I guess there was some fallacy that the mom said, and he included it in a letter to keep the kid out of vaccines. And, you know, it's not just the individual kid. We've talked about this before. When kids are vaccinated, it protects the rest of us whose vaccinations that we got as kids have kind of decreased in potency in our bodies. So we count on the kids taking the shot for us when we're in our 40s and 50s.
I didn't know that.
Herd immunity. Yeah, I mean, if there's less people walking around with measles because of vaccines, there's less chance, if you're an adult who lost their vaccine protection from the shot they got when they were 5 years old, that helps to keep us safe, too.
What are booster shots?
Well, what the researchers show is that it takes more than one. So sometimes with certain vaccines, it's one and done, but most vaccines have a series of three or four or five vaccines given at different times out from the original vaccine. Like, for instance, infants get the same four vaccines at 2 months, 4 months, and 6 months. So those are the first one, two, and three booster. They get a booster for DPT and Hib at 15 months, and then they get another DPT before kindergarten, and then another DPT at 11. So everything after the two-month visit is just a booster to keep the immunity up. Kids are happy when I tell them at 11 that they don't need another tetanus shot till they're 21.
Well, they're calling it vaccine choice. But by choosing not to get a vaccine, you're saying you're imposing your health risk onto others. But if your kid has all the vaccines, then it's not an issue.
Then they're going to be protected. That's right. So, but I do have kids in my practice that are on chemotherapy for different cancers. I have other kids that are on oral steroids chronically for other conditions they have, and their immune system is depressed because of the medicines that they're getting, and they're susceptible because they're, you know, even though they did get the vaccines, their body's response because of the drugs that they're taking to fight their cancer or their asthma or, you know, their lupus, they are less they're not going to have that protection. So they walk into my waiting room and there's a kid sitting there with the measles because the mom didn't have the kid vaccinated. And it's going to take me a week to figure out it's the measles because I've never fucking seen it. So he's going to spread it to more people. Mm. But that's why it's to protect, you know, and adults that are on chemotherapy or going through treatments for things like that. You know, they need to know that the children surrounding them are, you know, not shedding deadly viruses.
Is there an epidemic of autism in this country, or is there an epidemic of it being diagnosed?
It's a little bit of both. You know, I see, you know, maybe one or two new autistic kids a year. Certainly I have not seen, you know, they say it's 80% of boys. I can tell you I have not seen 80% of boys. I celebrated my 25th year of being in pediatrics practice yesterday. I hit the quarter century mark yesterday. And so I have some experience, but I have not seen the numbers they're reporting, but I certainly do see kids with it.
80% of all autism diagnosis is a...
80% of boys, the risk of autism in boys is 80% higher than girls. It's like a 5-to-1 ratio.
I see. Okay.
And they say that 80 out of 1,000 boys are going to have autism, which is a huge number when you think about it.
And we don't know what's causing this.
But we know what isn't causing it. And, you know, according to everything I've read, the vaccine seemed to be a non-issue, which means we should not be investing our time and knowledge and money in vaccines. We should be looking at what the hell the other causes are, because clearly we've exhausted the vaccine thing. So And there's a lot of good studies that are international studies, worldwide studies, that say there is no link between autism and vaccines. And I have to rely on that.
What about having children later in life? Does that increase the odds of autism?
The older the father of the child, the more ugly the baby is. That is statistically shown. And yeah, I mean, there is an increased risk of problems, you know, not just autism, but Down syndrome and such when people have babies later in life. So, you know, you want fresh eggs and fresh sperm. You don't want to, you know, have sperm that's been through the ringer for 30 years.
Right. Let's end on some happy news. What's some good news coming down the pike from the medical community?
Well, I thought the armpit thing was that's why I sent it. Jesus Christ, I haven't been able to wear a dress shirt in about 30 years. So.
Dr. Jay Sutay is the hardest working pediatrician in comedy. Are you performing at all?
No, I got a little bit of a lull. I might be at the Funny Bone in a couple weeks opening up for Justin McKinney, because I requested that. I think that's the 12th to the 15th, but the summer is a little slow. I'll be at City Steam in Hartford September 21st, 22nd, and that is my home club and where I love to perform. So it's in September. So
super. Take the summer off. Relax.
I thought we were doing a tour. The comments of the David Feldman Show. We had a show.
I know. I think we do have a show. I have to check. Stay on the line for one second. We'll discuss
that. Sure. Nice talking to you, buddy.
Stay on the line. If you're enjoying today's show, do me a favor and subscribe to it on iTunes, Stitcher. We have a YouTube channel. It's just audio, but some people like to listen to this show on YouTube, so subscribe to our YouTube channel and do me a favor and give us a good review on iTunes. You'd be amazed how much that helps. Giving us a good review on iTunes moves us up. That's the way their algorithm works. So when you give us a good review on iTunes, you're really helping out. Thank you.
go to Los Feliz, where Howie Klein is standing by. He is the founder and treasurer of the Blue America PAC, which raises money for progressive candidates all around America. He writes Down With Tyranny, and he has spent a lot of ink talking about Crowley. Is it Joe Crowley? What's his first name?
Yes, Joe or Joseph, whichever you would like to say. He used to be known mostly as Joseph Crowley, but in the last years, he's been known as Joe Crowley.
You taught me to hate him. You told me he was a bag man for Wall Street, and he was going to be, I don't know.
No, he was a good man for Wall Street.
Bag man.
He was a bad man for everybody else.
Bag man.
You said bag man. That's correct. He was a bag man for Wall Street. So
how shocked were you?
Totally shocked.
What happened?
Totally shocked.
Tell us what happened in Queens.
Let me start with my conversation with Alexandria a few months ago. So she called me up and she asked for a Blue America endorsement. And, you know, we talked. I ran her through the same stuff all the candidates go through. And she seemed extremely intelligent. And I know the district really well. I had previously called, and when I say previously, I mean in years, every elected in that district, both in Queens and more so in the Bronx, begging them to run against Crowley. And every one of them either laughed at me or cursed me or told me not to call again. Mm-hmm. Nobody would consider running against Crowley. So that's all the state senators, all the state assemblymen, all the city councilmen. I mean, everybody that could possibly run against Crowley, I have asked them for years to do it, and none of them wanted to.
We're talking about Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez.
Yeah, she called asking me if I could, called to ask me how she can get an endorsement from Blue America. So we went through the whole rigmarole, and she came out with flying colors. You know, she turned out to be a very, very progressive person with great ideas, and I saw over the course of several phone calls that she was a very, very hard worker, very intelligent, and is a perfect candidate for Blue America. The problem is that I felt she had no chance to win. And I don't mean she only had a little chance to win. I felt she had no chance to win. And I told her. And she said to me I was wrong and that she was going to win this thing. And I said, you prove it to me. Show me how you're going to do it. And she did. And at the end of the conversation, I didn't think she had any chance to win, but I thought she had a good vision. And I figured, oh, she could win in 2020. Let her run now. She could get people to know who she is. She'll get a good name ID. And then in 2020 is going to be another good year for Democrats. And let her run, you know, let her run then with, you know, more people knowing something about her. No one ever wins on the first time they run. Everybody, you know, takes two times, or at least. I mean, Alan Grayson didn't win the first time he ran. Donna Edwards didn't win the first time she ran. I mean, very few people win the first time they run, especially when you're running in a primary against a longtime incumbent. He had been in there for 10 terms. And I was thinking everyone knew him. And Alexandria corrected me. She said, no, you're wrong. No one knows him. When he was elected, no one who elected him the first time, even though he doesn't even live in the district anymore, she told me something I didn't know, that the district was now about 18 or 19% white. And this is, you know, this jovial Irish guy, Joe Crowley, that to him, that's his district. And he's the Queens boss, the machine boss of Queens. And he actually hired a lobbyist to lop the Bronx part of the district off his district. He didn't want the Bronx because it was too many people of color. They couldn't handle it. And he doesn't like the Bronx. He doesn't like going there. And I didn't know that either. Alexandria told it to me, and I looked it up, and sure enough, she was right. Now, it didn't succeed, but he was paying someone to make it succeed. But it failed. So in any case, she convinced me that she'd be worth endorsing, and that later that she'd be worth spending money on. So we didn't just endorse her and raise money for her. We did something that we only do for very, very few candidates, maybe 1 out of 10, which is an independent expenditure. That means we take the small amount of money that we have at Blue America and we do something independently. So at that point, I couldn't talk to her anymore, and we stopped speaking. And I hope she doesn't think that I didn't like her, but I couldn't, legally, you can't talk to someone when you're doing an independent expenditure. You're just spending the money without coordinating with the candidate.
You're a super PAC or a PAC.
It's like a PAC, yes, or something like that. So when I looked and I saw there were only two outside independent expenditures that spent any money at all in this race. So one of them was the Sierra Club, a very, very rich organization with millions and millions of dollars. And they spent a small amount of money, symbolic amount of money, to help reelect Crowley, because they always, you know, go with the establishment. That's what, you know, I mean, they have a good name and everybody likes the Sierra Club, including me, but they don't go with rebels. So they just spent a little bit of money, tiny amount of money on Crowley. And the other expenditure was done by Blue America. You know, we don't have much, but we spent what we could. We spent, you know, several thousand dollars. And we did, you know, we did a what we thought would help her on a grassroots level with phone calls and websites and people on the ground who were, you know, natives of the district and who did a great job in English and Spanish and Hindi, and it worked. I mean, it really worked. And by the way, when we were spending that money, it was part of my plan that's going to help her in 2020. It wasn't because I suddenly believed she was going to win. I didn't believe, even when the votes started coming in last Tuesday, literally, the votes were coming in. I was watching it and on the Secretary of State's website, and I'm seeing the votes coming in. And I thought, no, this is a mistake, because sometimes they get it mixed up, and it was just a mistake. But it wasn't. It kept coming. The votes kept on flowing. And I'm thinking, what the hell is going on here? Then I thought, oh, this must be from her neighborhood in the Bronx. That's what it is. It's just her neighborhood. Nope. I was then noticing both in the Queens part of the district and in the Bronx part of the district, she was winning everywhere. And it never stopped. She kept winning and winning and winning, and I'm flipping out. And I was thinking, God, I was so wrong. She's actually going to win this thing. And by the time about a third of the vote was in, there was no going back. I mean, she had it. You know, there was never a neighborhood that was coming in, or no precincts that Crowley was going to win. She was going to win from right in the beginning of the evening. It was like really got clear. And I think she was a little bit shocked too, although she did think she had a chance. But to her, it was a chance. To me, it was no chance. And yet she won. And she won, you know, she won very well. It wasn't like some close call or, you know, some situation where you have to, you have to have a recount. I think it was in the end, I don't know the exact number off the top of my head, but it was something like 58% for her, 42% for him. And that's pretty amazing.
That's a landslide.
Especially when you consider that he spent $3 million plus and she spent $300,000. So there's a big difference there.
Do you find it scary for November? Now, he was chairman, or I think he still is, of the Democratic caucus. How powerful
He's the fourth highest ranking member of the Democratic House leadership.
Right. Okay.
And as you and I have talked about over the past year, he was Nancy Pelosi's handpicked candidate to follow her as a speaker or as Democratic leader. You know, in other words, you're the Democratic leader, and then if the Democrats take the majority, you become the Speaker. So that was her plan and Hoyer's plan. And by him being defeated by this young woman of 28 years, that whole thing fell apart. And, you know, Nancy and the whole establishment, the whole Democratic establishment and the shills in the media who work with them, they're all in shock. I mean, and they're saying horrible things about her. So it's not just the Republican establishment that is, saying awful things about her, but it's the Democratic establishment, too. So on the one hand, you'll have someone like Ro Khanna, who, by the way, was the only member of Congress to endorse her. So you'll have Ro Khanna saying this is a great day, and you'll have some sort of lefties on the media saying how this is a great day. But then you've got, you know, Pelosi and the mainstream kind of D.C. media that takes whatever she says as gospel, all saying this is an outlier, that was the word she used, and Tammy Duckworth saying, well, those kind of values that she's expressing can work in the Bronx, but they're not going to work in the Midwest, meaning they're not going to work with white people, is what she was trying to say. And And that's bullshit, because she was running on a Bernie Sanders platform. She was she's a Bernie Sanders organizer, and she was running on Bernie's platform. And maybe Tammy Duckworth doesn't know that, but the Bernie won huge victories in Michigan, in Wisconsin, in Indiana, in North Dakota. I mean, all over the Midwest. Where he didn't win was in big cities where Hillary won, although he did respectably well. But he won lots of states in the Midwest. I didn't mention Minnesota, where he won also. So she's wrong. Tammy Duckworth is wrong, and she's just, like, you know, talking out of her ass, and doesn't know what she's saying. She's just all wrong. But that's her instinct. Tammy Duckworth, who's now a U.S. senator from Illinois, was trained literally by Rahm Emanuel. She was one of the Rahm Emanuel disciples, and you know what comes out of her instinctually will be this kind of negative thing. That, oh yes, she could win in the Bronx, but she can't win in the Midwest. You know, no, you're absolutely wrong. Now, Tammy Duckworth is a relatively conservative Democrat. I'm not saying she's a conservative when you compare her to Republicans. Of course she's not. But when you put her on display with other Democrats, she's on the right side of the equation.
She's from the military, a wounded veteran, severely wounded.
In the military, and she was severely wounded. And no one ever talks about her politics, because all they want to talk is about her being a double or triple or quadruple amputee. Great service that she gave to the military, which is true. But, she also has politics, and they're not good.
Right. Now, I'm concerned because as much as I agree with everything you're saying, I still want the Democrats to win in November.
Yes, I'm away from that. Don't vote for them anymore. It's so horrible with Trump that I'm, now suggesting to people that they, when there's the worst Democrats imaginable, that just hold their noses and just do it and, punish themselves later.
But I'm worried that this is what I'm worried about the Democratic establishment. They didn't see this coming. I mean, Joseph Crowley, of all people, should have seen this coming.
No, he kind of did. And I talked about that a few months ago, because suddenly Joe Crowley did something that he's never done before. He actually agreed to debate her. And the day that he agreed to debate her, I wrote on my blog and in Twitter that he has independent polling. He's got his own polling that's showing that it's a close race. And he by agreeing to actually get into the ring with a 28-year-old girl. She wasn't born when he was first elected to office. Literally, she wasn't born yet when he was in the state legislature. And for him to get going on a debate with her, that totally showed me that he sees that he's losing, or at least that she's gaining. And the fact of the matter is that he came to the debate totally unprepared. Like, I don't need to prepare. I'm Joe Crowley. And she kicked his ass. And you could just see halfway through the debate, he's thinking to myself, what did I do? I should have prepared for this thing. it was kind of pathetic that he got his ass kicked. This guy who's been in elective office for decades got his ass kicked by a young woman who's never been elected to anything.
You hated him almost as much as you hate Steve Israel. When Steve Israel retired, your hatred became focused on Joseph Crowley.
I don't like to call it hatred. I was a detractor of Joseph Crowley long before that. You can be against people more than one at a time. Rahm may be, the head of the snake. And I Steve Israel, I never liked him at all. But he had a couple of redeeming qualities, not many. And it's the same with Crowley. Crowley, he's a jovial guy who plays guitar. And, but he's, you don't look at that. You look at Joe Crowley is the Democrat in the House who has taken more money from Wall Street than any other Democrat in the House. I mean, come on, what does that tell you? Why are they giving him more money than Steny Hoyer? Why are they giving him more money than Nancy Pelosi? So earlier, when you were introducing this piece, you mentioned he was a bag man. And that's the reason. He has been building his internal power in the House with money from Wall Street. They know very well what they're getting. They're not giving this money to some random person. They're giving the money to the person who delivers for them. When he was, you know, he's on the House Ways and Means Committee, and they get to write a lot of the legislation that Wall Street is the most interested in. And he always seemed to be backing the wrong side. And not only that, but Crowley was the guy who would, after the elections, every year, he would take the freshmen down to Wall Street to introduce them and, you know, explain to them how they can get money coming in. Now, some of the freshmen, of course, didn't want Wall Street. They wanted Wall Street money, but they didn't want to be seen to be taking Wall Street money. So he would be the kind of guy that would be fine with it. He would take all the Wall Street money, and then he would give it out to other Democrats. So that's what a bag man does. You know, he would do it with Wall Street. Debbie Wasserman Schultz would do it with, for-profit prisons. She, you know, most people, most Democrats, they don't want for-profit prisons showing up in their financial accounts. So instead, they would take money from Debbie Wasserman Schultz, even though they knew some of that money was coming from for-profit prisons. But it doesn't show up that way on their accounts. It just shows up as a donation from Debbie Wasserman Schultz, not from a for-profit prison.
On the Ralph Nader radio show, I asked Ralph, what would happen if it were against the law for somebody like Crowley or Nancy Pelosi to give money to other Democrats? He said it would change the whole complexion, the whole nature of politics in Washington, D.C.
Ralph is right. And it's the same with the Republicans, by the way. You know, that's what they do. They also get immense amounts of money and they divvy it up. And that's how they buy power and influence inside their own caucus. I mean, I remember when Paul Ryan pretended he was being talked into being speaker. And one of the things he said, and I think he was sincere when he said it, was, I am not going to spend my weekends away from my kids. It's too important to me. And within a month, he was spending every weekend on the road getting money from rich donors. Mm-hmm. And recently, I have been trying to talk Ted Lieu into running for speaker. And Ted is saying to me, you know, Howie, I would love to do it, and maybe someday I can. But the truth of the matter is, I've got two young sons. I want to spend my time with them growing up because I'm not going to be able to do it later in life because they won't be growing up anymore. They'll be grown up. And he goes from L.A. to Washington every single weekend, and he spends time with his sons. And that's what his wife wants also. So he would be disappointing his sons and his wife if he were to do otherwise. So when I say, so you'll spend time with them too, he said, no, I won't. He said, if I am speaker, I am going to have to be on the road raising money, and that means not being with my kids. And he said, that's not acceptable for him.
This past weekend, I was shocked. Elizabeth Warren called for the abolition of ICE.
That's not exactly what she did. She called for the replacement of ICE with an effective organization that is not like the Gestapo. I mean, ICE has become the American Gestapo, and that's what she doesn't want. It's not like she just wants to open up the borders and let everybody in. That's not what she's saying. In fact, she was very clear that she wants to replace ICE, not necessarily to just have no border guards. That's not what she's looking for.
And Donald Trump gave an interview to Fox and said, please, Democrats, please call for the elimination of ICE. I could win so big.
Right, but it's not the elimination of ICE. Again, right. It's the replacement. Elizabeth Warren has a good plan to replace ICE, and that's what people are buying into. Remember, Elizabeth Warren isn't exactly the first person to be saying this. This has been, you know, the first person that I know of who said it, and I could be leaving people out, and there may have been other people who were saying it, but Randy Bryce came out with almost a year ago. He, as part of his campaign, he said, I want to see the replacement of ICE. And a lot of people flipped out and they said, oh my God, he's so radical, he's too extreme, and they were, you know, oohing and aahing and flipping out over him. And then same thing happened with Alexandria Ocasio. She said, yes, we've got to get rid of ICE. And there were several senators who did it, including Gillibrand. who doesn't have a good name with Hispanics anyway from other things that she's done in the past, but she said the same thing. So for Elizabeth Warren to come in, the reason why it's such a big deal is because she is the official messenger or message creator for the senators in the Senate. Schumer gave her that job. So that's kind of a leadership post. It's an official post where she's in charge of messaging. So for her to come out strongly for replacing ICE, that's kind of a really big deal. Now, that doesn't mean that, you know, people like Joe Manchin and Heidi Heitkamp are going to give the same message. It doesn't. It means they'll read her message and they'll take what they can use out of it. But, you know, I don't know how they feel in their hearts. I have no idea. But I know they cannot espouse even replacing ICE. They have to be big ICE supporters.
Substantively, ICE is unnecessary. I want to ask you about ICE politically. But first, let's establish the predicate that ICE is unnecessary. You agree with that? That they're not...
Well, they're unnecessary, but something is needed. I mean, they don't just lock up children. The lock up children part is what they want to get rid of.
But they're not getting MS-13. There's no evidence that they're rounding up MS-13. They find...
You're exactly right. There is not.
They don't...
Right.
They operate...
I don't even know that... wants them to round up MS-13. He talks about it, but he needs MS-13 as the boogeyman.
Right.
That Trump is into that. He loves MS-13 being there because he could, you know, throw that in the Democrats' face. I don't know why. I mean, but he says things like, Nancy Pelosi is practically a member of MS-13. She loves them so much. And that's, like, insane. And Trump is insane. But that's the kind of bullshit he says. And if there was no MS-13... he'd have to find someone else to use as a scapegoat.
Right. They operate not within but without the criminal justice system of the United States. There's no due process. They can identify somebody who looks Honduran and say, oh, that tattoo, you're MS-13, you're out of here. And then they put the numbers up on the board that said, look, we got rid of an MS-13 gang member. There's no proof.
They're El Salvadorian.
El Salvadoran, right. But that's what I'm saying, is like anybody who looks
yes.
like they're from Central America.
Do you watch Billions?
No.
So I'm going through I had missed it, and there are three seasons, and I'm on season three. So a few days ago, I was watching one of the episodes, and I won't go into the whole premise of Billions, but the bad guys needed to get rid of a witness who happened to have been extremely innocent, lovely young Guatemalan woman who was working as a maid, and they needed her out of the country. So someone from ICE came and rounded her up and put her on a plane, and the next day she was back in Guatemala.
And they're doing this
evidence, no hearing, no nothing.
They're doing this. They're doing this to American citizens as well.
That's right.
And they operate in
the
a
woman,
whole.
By the way, had her green card.
Yeah. They do this through detention centers. They do this through administrative justice. They don't have lawyers. This is very frightening. These are not military caliber heroes. These are union employees who are self-perpetuating and are more than willing to do Donald Trump's filthy work. And they're coming for you, America. ICE.gov, coming to a city near you, and they're not coming for the migrants. So we have to get rid of ICE.gov, and we have to scare Americans. They have to be frightened of ICE.gov. Politically, can the Democrats win saying get rid of a police force? I mean, you run on law and order. That's the big bell that you ring, right? How can you win?
The Democrats have to show that they're in favor of something that's better and more effective, and that's how they have to run on that issue. They can't run on just get rid of ICE. It can't be. They have to run on something, get rid of ICE, and replace it with something else. And I haven't heard Elizabeth Warren ever not use the word replacement when she talks about this. And same with Randy. Randy Bryce. They use the word replacement. Because they know that, I mean, it doesn't make sense to just suddenly get rid of ICE. You have to put something in to do the legitimate the legitimate functions of ICE. I mean, ICE isn't just completely, Donald Trump's Praetorian guard. They mm-hmm. do have some function, and some of those functions need to be in place. So well, that's what has to, so the Democrats should be thinking about that. And when they talk about getting rid of ICE, they should be able to explain to the American people what they're putting in its place.
How about we tell the American people we don't have an immigration problem? Could we explain that politically and say the fact is fewer Mexicans?
You could explain it to some people. And for the whole history of the United States, there are other people who disagree. They have, going back into the, even into the 1700s, when the country was getting started, there have been people that have had a problem with immigrants, let alone the 1800s, where it was a nightmare, and the early 1900s, where it was a nightmare. You know, the Ku Klux Klan didn't get popular. I mean, it was existed as an anti-black organization, but it didn't get really popular until it became an anti-immigrant organization. But the immigrants that they were talking about were from Germany, Ireland, Italy, and Greece. Those are the immigrants that the Ku Klux Klan was getting all riled up about. You know, people seem to not remember that anymore. Everyone in America, except for the Native Americans, were at one time they were immigrants. Although, what's her name? Ann Coulter says my ancestors were not immigrants; they were settlers. An idiot.
Yeah. Yeah.
We're all from immigrant families, and we should try to, get in touch through our inner selves with who those people were and what they went through. And I would say that 90% of them did not fill out visa applications,
right,
and come over here the way it's done now. I know my family didn't.
Right. It's not an immigration problem. It's a hiring problem. There are specific industries in America that need undocumented migrants to come to America and work on factory farms, work in slaughterhouses, pick our lettuce. That's baked into our economic system. We do not have an immigration problem. We have a political problem. We need to gin up hysteria to get people elected. This is not a problem. Now, I believe in a mixed economy. I believe in socialism and capitalism. You're a capitalist. I'm a capitalist. I think there's certain things that capitalism can do, but socialism is necessary. The government should be there to compete with big business to keep both ideologies honest. There is a strong socialist strain in the Democratic Party. I've never seen anything like this. People are saying, I'm a socialist. Is this going to backfire politically? I'm a socialist. I self-identify as a socialist. Is this going to backfire for us in the midterm?
They call themselves democratic socialists. And no, I don't think so. It certainly worked for Bernie to an extent. And I don't think it's going to be a problem. I mean, if we let Trump define us, then it's a problem. But it shouldn't be.
Okay. What do we keep an eye out for in the next couple of weeks? What big primaries are coming up?
None. There are no primaries in July. So we can all calm down until August, and then it starts up again.
Primary, like in Florida and...
Yep.
Yeah.
We have primaries in both August and, believe it or not, September. So there are a lot of primaries coming up, but none in July. July is rest time.
And before you go...
The things before we go that I want to do a shout out to Hawaii, because Hawaii was the smart state who decided that they're going to have primaries on Saturday so that people can actually vote without taking off from work.
Hmm.
So that's what they do. And Saturday, I think it's August 7th or 9th or something like that, but it's on a Saturday early in August. They have a primary. It happens to be a very important primary. And we'll be watching that real closely. The cool kids are all rooting for another democratic socialist named Kaniela Ng. Mm-hmm. And it didn't stop him from being elected over and over to the state legislature, even though he's a young guy and everyone would think he just got out of high school and he couldn't have run before, but he did. And he's had a very successful time in the state legislature. He's now running for Congress from the Honolulu seat. And it's Kaneala Inge. He's up against a whole gaggle of really, really conservative Democrats, the worst of the worst. In fact, the actual worst from the worst is Steve Case. No, that's the cousin.
AOL, the guy who destroyed
AOL,
time.
AOL, the guy Case from AOL is the cousin of Ed Case. Ed Case is running. He was already a congressman. He was a blue dog congressman from Hawaii. He ran for governor. He ran for senator. And he gave up his seat. And he said, I'm never running for Congress again. But like Nixon, he's back. And he's running against Kaneala, as are several other extremely conservative but very moneyed right-wing Democrats. Hopefully, Kaneala, who doesn't have any money, because he's the one progressive in the race, hopefully all of these conservatives will eat away at each other's voter base, and Kaneala gets it. But Kaneala is very much like Alexandria Ocasio. In fact, her first TV interview after her win was with Chris Hayes on MSNBC, and she did a shout out to Kaneala Inge on that first interview.
What are we looking at in November? What do you see happening on election day?
Yeah, I'm still saying that the Democrats can win 50 seats. They need to win 22, but I'm saying they can do double that.
And the Senate?
Senate is tough. It's hard to say. You know, the Democrats have some really, really bad candidates. I don't think it's going to matter, because I think that and this is borne out, by the way, by polling. I think that people are going to go to the polls and they're going to say, I'm voting against Trump or I'm voting for Trump. And it's not going to matter that much that, you know, someone like Kyrsten Sinema, the worst Democrat in the House, is running for the Senate. And she's terrible. She's absolutely terrible. But the fact that she's so up in the polling, like the Republicans haven't picked their candidate yet. They have three, and they're doing head-to-heads with the three, and she beats any one of them, and she beats them substantially. This is in Arizona, red Arizona. People want to put a check on Trump. And I think that's going to be the ultimate decision-maker, both in the House and the Senate. And if that's true, chances are the Democrats will win both. It'll be real close in the Senate. It's going to be either the Republicans hold on to it by a vote or the Democrats win it by a vote.
Not to be vulgar, but we could have two Democratic senators from Arizona. But John McCain is not doing well. And it is conceivable that within a year we could have two Democratic senators from Arizona, especially since Trump was just so disrespectful and continues to be disrespectful towards John McCain.
Yes. So when I'm, you know, I hope that John McCain lives a long life.
Right.
And for any reason is not in the Senate anymore. The person who's going to probably run, I think, is Ruben Gallego. Ruben Gallego is a military hero who is also a congressman from Phoenix. And, you know, he's a young guy. I am not certain that he's going to want to run, but I think he is. I think he would be the one. He would be the Democrat to run for that seat if it comes up. I'm not 100% sure, but he's the likeliest candidate. But who knows? You know, Arizona is a pretty conservative place, and they may think, well, they need another conservative Democrat to run. We'll see.
We'll talk to you next week. Howie Klein is the founder and treasurer of the Blue America PAC. Everybody should go to Down With Tyranny, read and follow Howie Klein. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Talk to you soon.
Can you stay on the line for 1 second?
Yes.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
Let's go to the Upper West Side, where Bernie Sanders is considered alt-right. Dr. Corey Brettschneider is the author of The Oath and the Office, A Guide to the Constitution for Future Presidents. There's nothing to talk about. Thank you for being on the show. Goodbye. Nothing
happened.
All
right. Good one. Best one. Shortest interview in world history.
You lost the travel ban for us. Your amicus brief. it's not even funny. But wow. They did cite your amicus brief. And
the dissent, yes.
And the dissent. Sotomayor mentioned it?
She quoted it and relied on it, I think, largely in her reasoning. One bizarre thing about the case, and I'm happy to talk about it, but is that there certainly were four votes that said it was constitutional. Anthony Kennedy's vote, the person that we're all paying attention to, he voted with the majority, but he also wrote a separate concurrence that talked about the fact that maybe we need more evidence. And there's a suggestion that scholars are debating about whether it's worth it to bring this case again in the lower courts. And if you look technically at his concurrence, he says, you know, there's a factual question here about whether or not there really is a security rationale for this thing. You know, a lot of people are saying it's dead. And I know a lot of people that I've worked with think it's not worth it. But when you actually read what he said, he didn't say that it's clearly constitutional. He said, as of now, there's not enough evidence to stop it, but there might be.
Evidence that those countries pose a security risk.
Well, he said that's the supposed rationale, of course, right? That it's not based on animus, that it's based on security. Now, we have gone through this without a full trial. Of the trial level, these things were decided as a matter of law all the way through the courts, and there wasn't a fact-binding trial the way that there would be in a lot of cases. And what Kennedy's concurrence actually says, you know, I'll tell you what I think about this, but what it actually says is, as of now, there's not the evidence to say that this is based in animus and that it's the security rationale is basically BS. We can't say that yet, but a trial might show that to be the case. So he didn't hold the president can do whatever he wants. He just held there wasn't enough evidence as of now to strike it down.
That's the concurrence, but that's not the final decision. Who wrote? Was it Roberts who wrote the?
Correct. Yes. Yeah, there were five votes that say there's a security basis for this policy and we're going to allow it to go through. And now the fifth vote, the vote that we were relying on, the Kennedy vote, the person that we thought for sure, given his past decisions, would say this is based in animus. He did this kind of cop out. Somebody called it weak sauce, the concurrence. You know, it says, as of now, we don't have the evidence to show that this is animus based and that the security rationale is a pretext. But we might if they relitigate this.
There were seven countries, five Muslim, mm-hmm. mentioned in the travel ban. Had they not included Venezuela and North Korea?
I don't know. I mean, it was a lawyerly trick. I mean, it's such a joke, the idea that these two countries are included to try to make it look not like a Muslim ban. My understanding, it was four people came from North Korea to the United States last year that would have been covered under this. So the idea that you would need an all you know, a ban. It's also ridiculous because, of course, people who want to come to this country from North Korea, we want them here so they can be interviewed and we can learn about what's happening in that country. Not to mention that now things have changed and we're probably not going to have a travel ban of North Korea because the two leaders of these countries really see eye to eye, evidently, on lots of issues. So it was a really gross lawyerly trick. I mean, it was a sort of silly thing to do. I think it probably did help them in saying that it's not a Muslim ban. But, you know, anybody who's paying attention knows what that is. It's just a ridiculous way of trying to pretend that this is not a policy based in hatred of Muslims.
They overturned the Korematsu decision.
Also a cynical ploy. I talk about Korematsu in the book and say that there is a need to do it. Now they've done it. But the way they did it, while upholding exactly the same kind of policy, was really, I just thought, gross. I mean, the dissent is saying that this is a similar issue to Korematsu and that you have a policy supposedly based on security that's really about racial prejudice. And we can't do that anymore. We did it in Korematsu. We're doing it here. And so for the majority to say, in the midst of a decision upholding racially and ethnically biased policy towards Muslims, that they're also reversing Korematsu, it turns it into a joke. I mean, to really reverse Korematsu would be to say, when we have a president signing executive orders based on prejudice, we're not going to allow it. Disgusting.
Yeah, we should remind people what Korematsu
is. Sure. This is during World War II. The president of the United States signed an executive order authorizing the rounding up of Japanese Americans and the placing of them into internment camps. And supposedly there was a threat in that community to national security. Now, they had studies done, internal studies, that showed that this actually wasn't a real threat somehow that was going to be taken care of by rounding up all Japanese Americans, including kids and their families. And they, you know, they were doing it because of a sort of fear and at the time hatred towards Japanese Americans. And yet the court, when it was faced with the question, same question that we're dealing with here, does the Equal Protection Clause limit the rounding up of Japanese Americans into internment camps? The court said, well, the security rationale here outweighs any of the equal protection concerns. And they upheld the executive order authorizing Japanese internment. Now, it's a similar issue here. Does the Equal Protection Clause, or in this case, we argued it for a variety of reasons on a more specific clause about discrimination against religion, the Establishment Clause, and the lawyer, Neil Katyal, who argued in the Supreme Court and argued this case, he said, you know, the president can't basically make policy based on animus towards Muslims in the same way he can't, despite what the court said during Korematsu, make policy based on bias towards Japanese Americans. And the court, you know, in this case said, we'll talk more about it, the majority said, there were five votes that said, the security rationale, the concern about these countries' vetting procedures outweighs any possible bias that might have been at the basis of the motivation, just like they did in this case. They supposedly reversed Korematsu. Did you follow that?
Yes,
was a lot.
Yes, yeah. And the governor of California during the roundup of the Japanese was Earl Warren, a Republican. You write in your book, The Oath and the Office, A Guide to the Constitution for Future Presidents, that had Earl Warren, I think it's in your chapter on federalism, you say that had Earl Warren stood up for the citizens of California, maybe Korematsu would have been unnecessary. Maybe Roosevelt would have backed down. He was a Republican, became the chief of the Supreme Court, right, Chief Justice, and went on to become perhaps the most liberal, most progressive Supreme Court justice in modern American history. He surprised everybody. Was he a reflection of the times? And speak to me, if you can, about Roberts. Is it conceivable that the Roberts Court, I think you once said that this was never really the Roberts Court, it was the Kennedy Court.
I do think that. I mean, it's technically the Roberts Court because you refer to the court by the Chief Justice, but certainly the most important member over the last decade, I would say, has been Anthony Kennedy, the swing vote on this court, and he was certainly the swing vote in this case. Sorry, so you said that you know, Earl Warren at the time, before he became Chief Justice, that's exactly right, that he basically implemented the executive order in California rounding up Japanese Americans. And your worry is that maybe Roberts is also just a sort of product of his time in
yeah.
this moment.
Yeah.
I mean, it's hard to argue that, though, isn't it? I mean, I think if there's a zeitgeist or a moment at this time, it's the recognition that Donald Trump is opponent at minimum of the Constitution, and that his motivations are not consistent with the basics of constitutional government. Kennedy basically acknowledges that in the concurrence. That's part of what makes it so weak sauce, in the words of my friend of mine who used that to describe the concurrence. So I, you know, it's not that people don't know better. It's just that he has a view of executive power, I guess, that is extreme in its amount of deference towards the chief executive. And that's not I think there are four votes for that view. There are four votes that say this order is unconstitutional. And there's one vote, the Anthony Kennedy vote, that says we don't have enough evidence. And we need to, you know, have lower courts look into this more. I think that's ridiculous. We have plenty of evidence, but that is Kennedy's view. It's not that it's clearly, without a doubt, constitutional. It's that we just don't have enough now to know whether it is or not.
Losing Kennedy is catastrophic. But before we get to that, is it conceivable that Roberts will step up now and play the role as the swing vote? He did make the argument for Obamacare.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, he will become the swing vote if there is a swing vote. And he has, in that case, and it wasn't a minor case, I think he voted in a way that's not obvious, you know, for a conservative justice to vote. And he did vote to uphold part of Obamacare. There are aspects of it that were struck down. He also upheld it in a way that's, you know, the headline was that he upheld it, and he did it
He showboated. It was a way of showboating too, right?
Yeah, I think he genuinely cares about the place of the court in American politics, and he might have pragmatically realized that striking down Obamacare might have been catastrophic to the court's reputation, to its ability to do what it does, strike down laws at points. And he did figure out a kind of, I don't know, you might say brilliant move of how to uphold the healthcare law and still strike at congressional power. He said that there was no Commerce Clause justification for the healthcare law, which is what the conservatives wanted. And then he said, but it's a tax, and that's why we're upholding it. Now, that's very wonky, but what it means is that he's opening the door to undercutting lots and lots of legislation that's based in the Commerce Clause. So the most famous thing that is based in the Commerce Clause that's controversial to some conservatives is the 1964 Civil Rights Act. So he's sort of striking at one of the bases of congressional power and at the same time voting to uphold the law. So he is a real conservative, I guess, is what I'm saying, even though he at moments might be a swing vote.
We saw the court overturn a public sector union rule where members of the public sector unions have to chip in for the price of collective bargaining. Mm-hmm. They use freedom of speech. They say forcing somebody to give money, which is speech, is a violation of the First Amendment, and also the association. You're free to associate with or without people you want to associate with. How far are we away from somebody coming before the court insisting that the income tax is a violation of the First Amendment?
I think there's legislation. There was an amendment, wasn't there, to enact?
Somebody challenging. Yeah. But the income tax is a constitutional amendment. Yeah. Right, I see.
Yeah, the 16th Amendment allows the Congress to levy an income tax. So I guess there's a possibility, and this court's never done this, that you could say that there is an unconstitutional constitutional amendment, but that would be pretty far-fetched. So
well, prohibition, I think that one is safe. Prohibition had to be repealed constitutionally, right?
Right, but I think this particular thing is safe because it is a constitutional amendment, the income tax. But what you're getting at is a very important point, which is the First Amendment is now a way for a conservative court to strike at a lot of progressive legislation. Now, the most egregious and famous example of that is the Citizens United case, which held that corporations from their own treasuries can give an unlimited amount of money in independent expenditure and sort of campaigning for or against candidates on their own. And that, is a way of striking at the heart of a lot of campaign finance legislation. McCain-Feingold limited the amount of public treasury money that can be used by corporations. And they used the First Amendment to do that. Now they've done it again in this union case. And a lot of people think that the way that the new Supreme Court might strike at progressive legislation is through the First Amendment. So you're right to point out that this is a way that lots of stuff might be challenged in the future. Certainly campaign finance limits of various kinds, which is, already underway. I mean, one thing is there's a limit in how much money an individual can give to a candidate directly still. And, there's a question about whether that's constitutional.
Is that Buckley Valeo?
There are a series of cases about this question. Buckley upheld the limit, but, it's open to question whether or not that's still good law after Citizens United, and especially, frankly, after in this next Supreme Court. I should say, Justice Kennedy voted with the majority in Citizens United. So as much as we're lamenting him leaving, he was not a liberal justice. He had lots of opinions where he was voting with the conservatives. There were a couple of areas where he was crucial to the liberal vote.
He wrote Citizens United.
Yeah, it was just, yes, he did. Justice Kennedy did write Citizens United, yes.
Yeah. Okay, let me ask you about Anthony Kennedy.
Yeah.
But before we do.
Yeah.
You're a
haven't done any jokes.
I know. You're a constitutional professor. Should the Supreme Court be this important? Isn't this more a reflection of gridlock in Washington, D.C. and Congress not doing its job? The future of abortion should not hang in the balance because of the court.
Yeah. I mean, I think that, look, we have a president that disregards the Constitution. in the worst possible way. And we have a Congress that, you know, has really abdicated lots of its traditional role, oversight, legislation, war powers, you name it, and has deferred to the president. And in this vacuum, what's happened over the last for years is that the court has stepped in. But I don't go as far as some people do to say we shouldn't have the power of judicial review in the Supreme Court. I think that there's a legacy that we want to keep of the Supreme Court and the Warren Court, a crucial moment, but not only, of protecting certain rights that Congress and the president failed to protect. And the abortion right is one of them.
Certain free speech rights,
and we could, you know, go through the list. So I'm not a fan of the idea that we should, in a kind of crude sense, abolish the power of judicial review, or in the even more extreme, I think actually absurd slogan, abolish the court itself.
So to me, the problem isn't Kennedy retiring. The problem is there isn't the political will in this country to make abortion legal. There isn't the political will in this country to protect LGBTQ rights. There isn't the political will in this country to change campaign finance laws. There isn't the political will in this country for stricter gun control legislation. Mm-hmm. All the power on these issues that have fallen on the Supreme Court, it emanates, it flows from the inability of the American people to elect congresspeople and senators who will pass laws that tackle these problems.
Yeah, I mean, I think you could kind of go through those different examples. In the abortion rights case, you know, there is the political will to protect abortion at the state level, but there isn't nationally. So that is a problem in democracy. What do we do about the low-income woman in Alabama that wants to have an abortion? Do we just sort of abandon her, or do we say that there's something about both the right of privacy and, as Justice Ginsburg has said, also the equal standing of women? That means that just because she happens to be in a state where there isn't the political will to do this, or in a country where there's not a will to do it nationally, that you know, we should just disregard her fundamental rights. And what Roe is about, and Casey, and all these cases protecting women, and earlier Griswold versus Connecticut, is the idea that there is certain dignity to individual decision making, regardless of where you live and regardless of the political makeup of your state. And I agree with that. I mean, the right to an abortion is built on an even more fundamental case that, who knows, maybe this case is also in jeopardy. The Griswold case, which is about the right to use contraception and to engage in family planning, if you want. And I don't think those rights should depend on whether or not you live in a state where a majority respects them. Some rights should not be, I think, put up for a vote.
Well, Chuck Schumer, the Senate Majority Leader, has a piece in the Times yesterday how the future of the country is hanging in the balance over the next Supreme Court nominee.
Yep.
Unfortunately, he's correct, but that's because the Democrats can't win properly and they can't push the issues in the Senate. Is it fair to say, just to be clear here, that the right to vote, giving everybody the right to vote, getting prisoners the right to vote, making sure that all African Americans can vote and don't have to stand in line, all the machines work, that can be solved constitutionally by a bill that the Senate and the House pass and the president signs?
No, because here's the problem, and this is why so much is at stake. Some of the examples that we were talking about might be solved by legislation protecting rights, like the abortion case, I think, is like that. But there are other cases where Congress has passed historic legislation. And what this new court, and actually the current court, is doing, and will do in an even more extreme way, is striking it down. So there is a Voting Rights Act that was passed in the 1960s. Providing all sorts of protections against discrimination by states when it comes to voting. And the Supreme Court, in a case called Shelby County, struck a big part of that down. Mm-hmm. Now, what if they strike down the entire Voting Rights Act? That's the central way that we protect against discrimination against African Americans and other minorities when it comes to voting. Now, the new Supreme Court could say, this is how extreme things could get, that the whole thing is unconstitutional. you know, we could go through the list that any right now, as I've said many times on this podcast, that yes, we could pass legislation tomorrow that would pass muster with the Supreme Court when it comes to gun control. But a new Supreme Court might be different. And you could kind of go through the list, and a lot of the things that we're taking for granted now that the Congress can do might be stopped by an extremist Supreme Court. And, you know, that's where we're heading. And somebody like Anthony Kennedy, I think, you know, who voted with the liberals sometimes, sometimes with conservatives, he had some bad views, some good ones, you know, basically stopped that from happening. Now, who's the person that's going to stop that in the future? John Roberts, you could say, possibly. I'm not convinced of that. I mean, you know, that's putting a lot of faith in somebody that has ultra-conservative views on many issues, much more so than Justice Kennedy.
If there were 80 Democrats in the Senate,
yep,
and there was a vast majority of Democrats in the House,
mm-hmm,
and the Supreme Court says this Medicare for All bill is unconstitutional.
Right.
What recourse would the Senate then have? They could rewrite the bill and make it. I'm sorry.
Yes. Sorry, I interrupted you. I apologize, David.
So how do you push back against an activist court that's just overwhelmingly conservative? You rewrite the bill without having to go to the states and pass a constitutional amendment, right, which is next to impossible.
Right.
If you had an activist judicial branch and an activist legislative branch, they say this bill is unconstitutional. Well, we want universal health insurance. We're going to rewrite it to make it constitutional. But you can't pass a law that makes something constitutional. You have to do an amendment.
You're asking a terrific question that, to me, is one of the most interesting ones in constitutional law. I'll give you the blunt answer.
Then let's move on then. That's just great.
A plus. No, really. I mean, this is, you know, it's one of the reasons, frankly, I love doing this podcast, is that, you know, I've done a lot of interviews about the court, and, you know, people want a kind of quick thing and then they go on. But what you're asking is about the deepest question in constitutional law, which is really who in this country has the final say over the question of whether something is constitutional or not. So in your example, and I'm going to give you a real case that answers this question, although it's deeply controversial, really going back to Jefferson and the origin of judicial review. But if the court says the legislation Congress passed is unconstitutional and the Congress comes back and tries to do it again or to fight the court, what happens? Now, the short answer is they can't do it. It's the court that has declared, at least in a case called Bernie, that its decisions are final on the matter of constitutional law. Now, that's a modern view. Jefferson thought there was a view called departmentalism that said the different branches basically had co-equal power to interpret the Constitution. But in a case called Bernie, there was a dispute about how to interpret the free exercise clause. And the Congress passed a law saying that the court should go back to an old way that it had been doing it, to basically, you know, protect people like the baker in the famous Baker case that we just talked about in Colorado, much more than it was allowing for. And the court in a case called Bernie came back and said, sorry, we answer the question in the final way. We are basically supreme in our judgment when we disagree with Congress. Now, that doesn't mean Congress can do nothing. They can try to, within the limits established by the court, try to fill in the blanks and try to work with, you know, what the court decision has said. But if the court just says point blank, there's no constitutional way to protect voting rights, that would be an absurd thing to say. But if they did say that, then there's really nothing that Congress can do, because the court can just strike down the next piece of legislation. So that's why there's so much at stake. You know, the court, given its enormous power in our society, can say all sorts of things that Congress cannot fight back against. Sometimes it can, but, you know, Citizens United is a good example. If they came back and said, no, we disagree, corporations are limited in how much money they can spend from their own treasuries, the court would say, no, we answered this question already. That legislation is, again, unconstitutional.
Now, Roosevelt. Yeah, of course.
That's a pretty complicated point, but I'm glad that we're talking about it. I'm pretty sure there's no other, you know, comedy podcast in which there is an extensive discussion of the difference between judicial supremacy and departmentalism. So
you can impeach a Supreme Court justice. Chase,
yeah.
J.P. Morgan Chase, the famous.
I mean, that was a long time ago.
I made a joke there. the famous justice, J.P. Morgan Chase.
Yeah. No, it was. What is Chase's real name?
I think it was Sammy Chase.
Yeah. Nice. Very nice.
Sammy Chase was impeached, but he wasn't thrown out of office. So you know,
this is like the very beginning of the 19th century.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just not a common occurrence. You know, there was a movement to impeach Earl Warren, of course, that never succeeded. It's very unlikely that there'll be an impeachment of a Supreme Court justice, no matter what happens.
And before we get to Kennedy and his table manners, because you had lunch with him last year, FDR...
We talked about the sandwiches that I didn't want to tell you what he had, but I did tell you about my sandwich, which I believe was the turkey on rye.
FDR didn't like the way the court was ruling on his New Deal, so he packed the court.
Mm-hmm.
And then that got struck down by the court or by Congress? I don't remember.
He never did it. He backed down. He was threatening to add justices to pack the court because there's no constitutional bar on adding justices. The story is what that caused, what you're thinking of, is something called the switch in time, where basically the court back down and maybe this is what you were saying, in their decision making they started deferring more to him, but he never actually had to do it.
Oh, is that where the term a switch in time saves nine?
Exactly, that's it.
Wait a second, I finally learned something from you.
You've got all these different things in your head, maybe from your classes at Columbia that you were half paying attention to.
Switch in time saves nine. So the switch would have been like the paddle that hurts the court?
No, it was the switch in the decision making that there were really two areas of law that the court switched its votes on. They claimed, you know, all sorts of things about consistency, but basically, yes, they switched their votes in two crucial areas. One was about federal power and upholding the New Deal, and the other was about a case called Lochner, which was basically limiting what states and also the federal government could do when it came to progressive legislation. And instead of continually saying this is unconstitutional in regard to New Deal legislation and also state legislation, the court said, okay, we're going to start deferring more to legislatures and to Congress. That's the switch. There's in particular a case, I think the scholars argue about what the specific case is, but there's a case called West Coast Hotel about minimum wage that is one place where the switch is marked between striking down legislation and upholding it.
The threat to packing the court was political, and the court responded accordingly. They behaved.
Yeah, they did. And, you know, you could see how that's controversial. Imagine that Donald Trump was, you know, threatening to pack the court unless they changed their decisions.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you know, historically, it was such a fundamental shift in constitutional law. And I think many scholars, including myself, think it was so important. You know, the New Deal was what saved the country in many ways. And a court that was striking down the New Deal was imperiling the basic ability of this democracy to function. I also think it was doing it based on pretty dubious constitutional arguments. So, you know, I don't know that he was unjustified in doing it and that he was wrong. It was an emergency kind of situation, and he was responding accordingly. The case, as I said, that marked the switch in time was about minimum wage legislation in Washington state. There was a hotel that didn't want to pay the minimum wage. And, you know, the court had before this case in 1937 been saying that you can't have minimum wage legislation because it violates the due process clause of the 14th Amendment. And then partly because of the pressure of Roosevelt, maybe entirely, the court changed its mind in this specific case, 1937, and said, okay, we're going to allow minimum wage legislation. But that was just one example of many in which the court started deferring to progressive states and also to President Roosevelt and his desire to pass a New Deal.
Before we get to Kennedy,
mm-hmm.
because McConnell deployed the nuclear...
Can I just say one more thing about this? Because it's sounding a little wonky and historical, but it does sort of bring home what we've been talking about. There are people who think, I mean, this is going to be the new story. This is possibly worth a book. Not just people. This is going to sound shocking to you, but I have to really stress it. And we have to find ways of getting this message out. The risk of the new court is that there is a view called the constitutional in exile that holds that that earlier view, pre-1937, saying that things like the minimum wage are unconstitutional, things like maximum hours legislation, things like child labor legislation, that the court actually was right before 1937 to say all these things were unconstitutional. And the entire administrative state, the entire set that we take for granted of workers' rights legislation is all wrong, all illegal. And what a new court should do is bring back the precedents of the pre-New Deal, pre-1937, pre-switch-in-time court, and strike down basically everything. Go through the list, right? Environmental Protection Agency, the entire administrative state, workers' rights, the NLRB, the National Labor Relations Board. In its most extreme, there is a view that says that that old view that all this stuff is unconstitutional has been exiled and was right all along since 1937. Now, that should sound shocking to you, but I'm trying to tell you the truth, which is that's what's at stake in this next nomination, certainly the next few.
When Steve Bannon said he's coming to Washington to dismantle the administrative state, what he's right. saying is he's a reactionary who wants to revert back to the Republican rule in the 20s.
Right. And he looks like an extremist. He is an extremist, of course. And he did it, not just wanted to, they're doing it right now through the helping to elect a president who was devoted to destroying the federal government. And, you know, things like the Department of Education, the EPA have been gutted under this administration. Now, what's even more scary to me, that's bad, but it can be reversed through a new election of a new president. But what would be very hard to reverse, maybe impossible, is the election of a court who holds that Steve Bannon view, but holds it as a constitutional argument. Because those people are there for life. And as I just told you, they can stop a president, they can stop a Congress, and basically through the court undo forever the administrative state.
This is great. I want to get back to this because I keep asking myself, you know, what is the end game? Keep asking myself, what is the end game here? What do these people really, really want?
Right.
They'll never tell you what they
want. I'm telling you that if you study this field and you're in it, you know that's what they want. And this that's not just them. That is a view of a certain set of scholars. I think Justice Thomas, for one thing, holds that view. Could very well be that Justice Gorsuch holds it. And, you know, look it up. The Constitution in exile, it's not a sort of it's not a unknown view in constitutional law. It's very well known. And there are people pushing for it.
Is this the Federalist Society?
The Federalist Society, you know, I've been to the Federalist Society and given talks there and done debates, and it's got a lot of members in it, and certainly many who do not have this view. But yes, there are some people who are, I guess you could say, one of their affiliations is the Federalist Society who hold this view. And there are views, I mean, more importantly, on the list of, there are some judges who are being considered who have something like the constitutional in exile view, yes.
You know, we forget that.
And
that,
some of them are on the court. I mean, that's also important to remember, right? We're not starting from zero.
I want to get back to that in the coming weeks. We forget that it was McConnell who deployed the nuclear option.
Yep.
A treaty would require how many votes from the Senate in order to ratify a treaty? It's what, 60 votes?
You need 2/3.
Oh, well, this is math.
67.
You need 67. How many?
I get very nervous when there's math involved, and when you're asking for the exact number, I got to be sure.
Okay, let me ask you. How many votes do you need in the Senate to pass a treaty?
67.
67 votes.
2/3.
There's nothing in the Constitution instructing the Senate what percentage of votes they need to confirm a Supreme Court justice.
No, it says majority.
A majority. So yeah. There was a Senate rule that said 60 votes were necessary.
Correct, right.
And it was McConnell who got rid of that. Now it's
during the Gorsuch, during the Gorsuch fight, which first moments that I stopped just being trying to do scholarship and try to get involved, I you know, was one of the people saying this guy is an extremist, basically don't confirm him. And I wrote two pieces, one about abortion, saying that he's certainly pondered the possibility, not just that Roe should be reversed, but that there should be a national ban imposed by the Supreme Court on abortion. I also thought, still think, and I think have been shown to be right, that he does not respect the precedents when it comes to gay rights. He thinks they're wrong, and I think he would get rid of them if he could. So for those two issues, there were others as well. There was the issues about the administrative state, for instance, that we were talking about. There was the famous trucker example. You know, there was a fight to stop him. And McConnell realized that the Democrats, if they kept the filibuster rule, might be able to stop the nomination, and so got rid of it. And through Senate rules, you can get rid of a Senate rule. And we went from needing a supermajority to confirm a Supreme Court justice to only needing 51.
Which allows for more extremists to sit on the court. And Gorsuch is an extremist.
Primary example, despite the fact that not everybody quite realized that at the time. I hope they do now.
One of the criticisms of Obama is that he nominated Merrick Garland, who was a centrist, and that had he really wanted to push him through McConnell, he should have nominated some 40-year-old Latino judge from California, which would have painted McConnell in a corner and forced him to put
I mean, you know, when it comes to the strategy, it's like they refusing to even hold hearings on Garland. They would have done that with anybody. I don't know how we could have stopped them. I think the thought was, you know, the next election will be fine. There'll be a Democrat president, and then they won't be able to keep it forever. But they, man, they were just devoted to not. And that vote, that stolen seat, is the fifth vote that we keep talking about. The travel ban would have been 5-4.
Right. But they say that had Obama gone bold.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't know that anything was going to work, frankly, at that moment. They're not actually going to consider him at all. And how do you force the Senate majority leader to consider a Supreme Court justice if you're the president? I mean, we could look back and he should have done this and he should have done that. I don't know what they could have done. It was the Senate, in the most gross way, refusing to do its duty. He claimed, you know, there is a precedent that you don't consider a Supreme Court justice in the last year of the president's term. I mean, I'd never heard that before, and it was false.
What is your final verdict on Kennedy? You had lunch with him. What did he eat?
I told you that's classified. You can't.
Oh.
I can't share that, no matter how often you keep asking me. My final verdict? Just a terrible disappointment when this travel ban case. One thing I didn't say, I've written a piece in Politico that I think we shared online that people can look at, but it's not just that he voted the wrong way. You know, okay, fine, you voted the wrong way. It's not just that this concurrence was weak sauce, as my friend puts it. It's that everything that he had ever done in the area of gay rights and the area of this animus doctrine that he created said that, including 21 days before.
The animus doctrine, Lukumi.
Kate case, Lukumi, yeah. But not just Lukumi. It's in Lukumi. It's in the Lawrence versus Texas, the idea is there. In Romer versus Evans, in the town of Greece. He always has consistently said, including in Masterpiece Cake Shop, which we talked about at length, that if a government official or a government body or a lawmaking body makes a law based on prejudice in regard to religion or ethnicity or race, that invalidates the law, especially if it's the prime motivation for the policy. This wasn't, you know, just something out of thin air that somebody else came up with. That's his legacy. That's his main contribution to jurisprudence. That's what he'll be famous for. That's what we'll teach about in 30 years. And when it came down to the most important application of that idea in a case involving the president, he failed to do what was required. It was baffling to me. You know, he didn't deny that. He wrote this sort of, we need more evidence. That's ridiculous. We don't need more evidence. We know that the travel ban is based on a motivation to discriminate against Muslims. It wouldn't exist apart from that. And they tried to paint over it. And here was his chance to use his own doctrine that he had created, that he should, by the way, get lots of credit for. I mean, this is the person who penned the opinion giving gay couples the right to marry, making it illegal, unconstitutional to put people in jail for consensual sexual relations. He had done all of that, and it all was supposed to lead to this final moment of saying, sorry, Mr. President, you're a bigot. Now, he did basically say in the concurrence, Mr. President, you're a bigot. but he failed to follow through by saying the policy was unconstitutional. That's a huge, not just disappointment, but stain on his legacy.
Indulge me a little sizzle. It's undignified, but he's got a son, works for Deutsche Bank. Deutsche Bank is the big lender to the Trump family. There's stories going around that the son lent Trump over a period of years $1 billion. Trump knows Kennedy's son. They were in public once, and he said to Kennedy, I think it was at the State of the Union, you know, say hello to your son. Mm-hmm. Is it conceivable that there's something going on and that Kennedy was protecting his? I mean, they got to him. There were meetings that were held at the White House before he retired. Can you get to a Supreme Court justice?
I got to say, as a scholar of constitutional law, somebody who believes in the rule of law, it is beyond upsetting to think that that's possible. I haven't seen enough to suggest that is what happened. Would Donald Trump try? Of course.
Yeah.
I mean, the guy is, you know, had a whole history, a whole career from day one of inappropriately trying to influence judges, politicians, you know, you name it. So would, you know, is it beyond question to think he would try? No, I think of course he would. He certainly, they were sending messages to try to convince him to step down. So how awful. I mean, we just have to wait and see. Certainly this is something that we have to see how it develops. I mean, I haven't seen enough to condemn Kennedy or claim this is what happened, but you know, we know this president has no respect for the rule of law, no respect for the Constitution, and sees judges and lawyers and all these people in the way he sees real estate law. You know, it's stuff, little regulations, little peddly things to get around. You hire people, pay them a lot of money to do what you want to do. You know, is the Supreme Court, you know, above that? Does he somehow exalt it in a way he doesn't other judges and lawyers? No. I think he sees it the same way. And so it's certainly not, it's certainly within his character to think that he would have tried to do anything he could to get a next justice to, you know, let's not forget what's going to, what's really, there are many things on the table. I mean, my God, we just talked about the administrative state, the future of abortion rights. The other thing is the investigation of Mueller. There are people going around saying that the investigation is unconstitutional. A president can't investigate himself. And so the whole thing has to be gotten rid of. Now, the next court, the next justice might be deciding that case. Now, of course, Trump cares about influencing who's going to decide that. And of course, he's going to try to pick somebody that he thinks will protect him.
Going back to conspiracy theories, and then we'll wrap it up. There is political horse trading when it comes to the Supreme Court. I mean, LBJ, Lyndon Johnson, was guilty of it. I seem to remember reading somewhere that there was a guy named Arthur Goldberg who was on the Supreme Court. He had the Jewish seat. LBJ talked him into stepping down from the Supreme Court so he could be the ambassador to the UN, so that LBJ could nominate a friend to the Supreme Court, and Goldberg did it. That felt like horse trading. Ramsey Clark, one of our greatest attorney generals, I think, under LBJ, was appointed, but that required his father, Tom Clark, to step down from the Supreme Court. They didn't think it would be appropriate for the son to be the attorney general and the father sitting on the Supreme Court. So Tom Clark stepped down. So there is horse trading that goes on.
Yeah, I mean, the other thing that goes on, which we haven't talked about, but I, you know, when I was a graduate student, I had this kind of incredible sit down with Justice Scalia, where he was unbelievably honest over a couple of hours. And I mean, at some point, I'm going to try to write about what he said. He said many things. But one thing that was very interesting is that there was a guy, this European law professor, who said to him, you know, in Europe, the idea that a justice would time his or her stepping down by the partisan affiliation of the president in power would be, you know, outrageous. They're supposed to be independent from politics. And Scalia said, no, you know, that's my right. I can step down whenever I want. And that's how we do it here. And, you know, that's the other thing that definitely happened here, is that Kennedy considers himself a Republican. He clearly wanted to step down during a Republican administration. And he did that despite the fact that, let's be honest, the next justice, because of this decision, will wipe away, or certainly try to wipe away, his entire legacy. The next justice is not going to be devoted to the animus doctrine or to gay rights or to gay marriage or to the right to an abortion. I mean, all these things that Kennedy really helped to preserve or establish are going to be destroyed. And why is that? Because, you know, in the end, that partisan affiliation really matters when it comes to at least to stepping down.
Great. Well, you're welcome.
Thank you, sir, again, for all your that you've done for me and taught me. Every time we do this, I remember that you are a fine scholar who happens to be funny. Many people think you're a comedian who happens to do serious work on politics. It's the other way around. And again, thank you, sir.
Yes, you remind me that I don't say you're welcome enough.
You don't, and I appreciate that. Too kind. And every day is your welcome day on the David Feldman podcast.
Professor Corey Brettschneider is the author of When the State Speaks. His new book is The Oath and the Office, A Guide to the Constitution for Future Presidents. Stay on the line for 1 second, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
Let's go to California, where Emil Guillermo is standing by. He is the host of the PETA Podcast, People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals. The PETA Podcast drops every Wednesday. Listen to it. Emil, besides being an award-winning journalist, writes over at the Asian American Legal Defense and Education Fund. And we got a lot to talk about. Hello there, Emil.
Hello, David Feldman. I am standing by.
You're standing by. Before we get to the Havasupai horses, July 4th, Ben Franklin, and the you wanted to talk about Karamutsu, that decision. But yeah. First, let's hate Tess Thompson Talley from Kentucky. She posted photos of herself from a year ago where she did some big game hunting in Africa and killed a giraffe and posed next to her. I think Donald Trump Jr. has a new bride. She's blonde, stupid, carnivorous, bloodthirsty.
Yeah, I don't. I just don't get it, you know. And that was a year ago. I guess she's so proud of her trophies, of her meanness, of her just murderous ways that she wants to post that. I mean, it's one of the reasons why I just kind of go through all that in social media. But I understand that there's been quite a protest over this.
She's getting death threats. Mm-hmm. She posted, I guess, on Twitter or Facebook, a picture of her standing or kneeling next to a dead giraffe who was 4,000 pounds. And she wrote, "Prayers for my once-in-a-lifetime dream hunt came true today. Spotted this rare black giraffe bull, stalked him for quite a while. I knew it was the one. He was over 18 years old, 4,000 pounds. And was blessed to be able to get 2,000 pounds of meat from him," unquote. Giraffe meat.
Wait, is she talking about a giraffe or her first husband?
She is one despicable human being. Is there any justification for killing an 18-year-old giraffe? Are they? I would assume they're an endangered species, right?
Well, an 18-year-old giraffe, I mean, once you reach a certain age in certain communities in America, you feel like you're home free. I mean, I know it's tough, you know, for people to get beyond a certain age and in certain communities in the United States. But an 18-year-old giraffe should feel like, hey, I've done it. I'm free of the vermin with the shotguns who are out to get me. And It's just sad to see someone like this, post on the internet and feel so proud of this. So
what is the PETA stance on big game hunting? Is it ever justified? Because you will hear deer hunters in New York say we're thinning out the herd. This is good for the population. Is it ever justifiable?
I have never seen anything on any PETA documents or any PETA media saying, hey, well, you know, there are certain exceptions. No, I have never seen anything like that.
Hunters, mostly from America, will pay up to $120,000 for the privilege of traveling to Africa and trophy hunting. Lions, leopards, rhinos, buffalo, and deer.
Well, this is the thing about these wreck. I guess that they're not really eco. It's not really ecotourism because you're shooting big game. That's not. But it's this sort of this urge that people have to do these kind of vacations, these kind of tours, and it involves killing, and it's just so disheartening. And especially to see, but you know, look, I don't think what's happening to this woman on the web is worth it. I don't think she should get death threats. I think she should be calmly sent away and, you know, made to, you know, turn her head in the corner or something. But I don't believe, you know, her life should be taken. So I just think overall, though, it's good to be reminded that there are people out there like that, and that we need to get the message out. Clear that under no circumstances is this sort of thing ever justified or ever okay, ever all right.
What does it say about a person who shoots a giraffe and kills it? What does it mean?
Well, I having never done anything, just from as an observer, it's. I don't know, someone wanting to prove their self-worth by climbing here's this animal, this beautiful animal, 18-year-old giraffe. I mean, one should sit back and wonder at this. You should sit back and admire it. Should sit back and look at its beauty instead of saying, oh, this is mine. I'm going to kill it. And that makes no sense.
Yeah. Well, July 4th is upon us. Are you going to have a veggie burger? Are you going to have a genetically modified impossible burger, which Bill Gates is behind? Because they've isolated the gene inside meat that creates the bloody taste, and the impossible burger now, it has the hemo molecule so that when you cook it, it bleeds. Do you find that satisfying?
Well, I don't know.
Either do I.
The answer is no. In fact, I have a problem with the impossible burger, and I'm not sure what PETA's official stance is on that. Once again, I speak for myself. There are places in around where I am where you can get the Impossible Burger, and I have no desire to replicate the experience at all. You know, none at all. I mean, considering the tasty alternatives out there, and you know, actually, if I were a meat eater, a burger. At the grill or on the grill would not be my go-to, would not be my first go-to.
People have asked me about lab-grown meat because, do I hear a dog in the background?
Oh, yeah, that is my dog. You know, this is a PETA household. we have dogs. That must be the mailman. The postman barks twice.
What kind of dog do you have?
We have a raucous border collie, and you know they are very very respectful of our borders and don't want. Actually, it would be great if Trump hired a bunch of border collies.
Now, border collies, when you have parties, don't they kind of walk around? Herd the guests?
They herd the guests. Don't go to that room. Stay out of that room. That's where, you know, mom and dad don't want you in that room. They went to herd you next to the drinks or something.
No, seriously. I have heard that border collies work. And they've been bred to keep sheep within the border, not to cross over into property that doesn't belong to the shepherd. And people say that when they have parties in the backyard, the border collie will just keep people together into a, yeah, like a herd. We'll herd them together.
They're herding dogs, yes.
But exactly. Seriously, do you see that happening?
Yes, they do. They do it when dogs visit, and dogs that don't like herding, like pit bulls and shepherds and things like that. They always get into slight altercations with our dogs. But as far as people go, yes, people get herded too. But people usually, they pet them and they give them food and the dogs ignore them. But it happens. Yeah, it happens.
July and now 4th. She's gone. July yes. 4th. And July. You're going to have hot dogs, but they're not going to be beef.
They're not going to be beef. They're not going to be actually there. There are a lot of products. You know, when I first became vegetarian in the 80s, the number of products were so few and far between. There was these Loma Linda hot dogs. Have you ever seen them in the can? They're disgusting.
Yeah.
Have you ever had those?
No.
Loma Linda, they're in a can, and the technology and the whole enterprise of finding an alternative to the hot dog has been so good that there are at least, two or three or four brands out there that you can recommend to friends. I mean, on the PETA website, they talk about the Tofurky beer brats.
Mm-hmm.
And Tofurky, just as a brand, is a nice, rolls off the tip of the tongue, Tofurky. Mm-hmm. I like to say it. I like to say it more than I like to eat Tofurky. I mean, Tofurky is not my favorite, but there is another brand, Gardein, which makes, they make hot dogs, but they're known for their beef tips. They have these beefless tips that they make, and they make a black bean veggie burger that's mm-hmm. vegan that I love. So Gardein is out there. But my favorite, I don't know if people can get it just anywhere, but it's a company called Field Roast. Field Roast Grain Meat Company. They make these artisan Frankfurter vegetarian, totally vegan hot dogs.
Mm-hmm.
And they're great. They taste great. And here's the other thing for people who are real protein freaks, they got to get their – this – The Field Roast Frankfurter packs 21 grams of protein in a single link, which is a lot of protein for people who are like weightlifters or who, are protein, nuts, and they've got to have their protein fix. So anyway, I'll probably have a Frankfurter too.
Yeah. Look, yeah. I know a lot of my listeners, most of my listeners aren't vegetarians, aren't vegan.
Yeah.
That's okay, but you're wrong. You're morally wrong. You cannot justify it. And every doctor says you need to switch to a plant-based diet. Every environmentalist says if you cut down on your beef, you will be lessening your carbon footprint. You right. cannot justify a hamburger. It's murder. It's poison. It's poisoning you and the planet. And you're killing something. You're putting death inside it. Somebody agrees with me.
Yeah. The dog is a nice barometer for truth.
Now, do you feed the dog a vegan diet?
We go with, I don't know. I just take the dog food my wife gives the dogs. We try to go vegan. If there's meat in the dog food, we generally will avoid it. We've been going with our dogs are older, so we like to get them healthy food. So because sometimes we just lost one. And sometimes we think it's the food that contributed to his earlier than normal demise. But anyway, David, the truth is, I don't know. I don't know if we give our dogs a vegan a vegan diet, but I know that we will have a vegan diet on the 4th of July. You know, as is the custom in the Guillermo household on these special holidays, we like to get together and have a meal with a meal. So
that's a great, we should do a show called A Meal with a Meal.
A Meal with a Meal. Yeah. We have those funny little mirrors that they have in the kitchen sets and the studios, and we can cook something. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, but I, like on MLK Day, my young daughter would, you know, she wanted a chocolate cake and she wanted to read some of her favorite Langston Hughes poetry. And so we did that one year. And then, on Cinco de Mayo, we have the beans and rice and read from some Mexican poets. And so on the 4th of July, you know, poetry, I was at a thing where I had to come up with a poem or bring a poem. And a lot of people, when they think poetry, the first thing that comes to mind, you know, probably is something that, you know, a poem of their past, like, you know, if they were into the beat poets, maybe, you know, Ginsberg or, you know,
Ruth Bader Ginsburg also wrote poetry? Wow.
Yeah,
I know she wrote rap.
Yeah, she was the SCOTUS poet. Mm-hmm. Poet. You know, there's also, you know, or maybe you'll pick up a love sonnet or John Keats, you know, I like those opiate-riddled poets of the romantic past. And so I came up with this point. Did you know for the 4th of July, you know, Benjamin Franklin was a poet? Did you know that?
I would assume he did everything.
Yeah, he did. This is known to be Benjamin Franklin's best poem. And I know this guy, I went to the internet. It's called Death is a Fisherman. It's a short poem. I'll share it with your audience because, you know, if you came to the Guillermo barbecue where we have our vegan hot dogs, we'd sit around and then with our star spangled napkins afterwards and, you know, and drinking our Pabst Blue Ribbon beer, we would then say 4th of July themed poems. So okay. This is Benjamin Franklin. Death is a fisherman, the world we see. His fish pond is, and we the fishes be. His net some general sickness. However, he is not so kind as other fishes be. For if they take one of the smaller fry, they throw him in again. He shall not die. But death is sure to kill all he can get, and all is fish with him that comes to net. That's Benjamin Franklin. So he believes in catch and release. Okay, so that was sort of progressive somewhat, but death. This is dark Benjamin Franklin with the dark glasses, not the clear, funny granny glasses. Mm-hmm. This is the dark. Death is a fisherman. That's Benjamin Franklin. But now, you know, the other thing about poetry is that poetry is really of the now. And it's not just, you know, listening to Drake lyrics. It's real. There's real poetry out there. And the real, I want to honor on the 4th of July, the real poets out there. And there are many. They aren't even ink-stained wretches. They're just the people who are, you know, graduated from MFA programs, or maybe they went on and got their PhD and they're toiling away at junior colleges or in English departments. And I honor them on the 4th of July because they're the true artists and they're the true purveyors of real emotional thought, you know, in America these days. I mean, it's not, like I said, it's not the rappers, it's not Instagram, it's not Twitter. It's the poets. And if you go to poets.org, you'll know what I mean. And all the diverse voices you'll find there at poets.org. So I found this one poet. Her name is Elizabeth Knapp. And she's the winner of the Robert H. Winter Memorial Award in 2018. So this is an award-winning poem. And the award-winning poem is about the 4th of July. So this is Elizabeth Knapp. And this is going to prove to you that the 4th of July, or that poetry is in the now. It's in the moment. It's not the past. It's not a love sonnet. It's not, you know, anything you knew from high school or college. Poets are talking about stuff of today. So here's Elizabeth Knapp, 4th of July. In America, we like our flags fixed and rolled in powdered sugar, which is why fireworks always remind us of bombs, the shock and awe of a mighty nation. After the parade, I feel an overwhelming urge to take a hot shower. Americana, like grease over everything. If you asked two of us the same question, you'd get six different answers, depending on which side of the news you're on. On the outskirts of town, a band is playing well into the night. Some of us are sleeping. Some of us would kill us in our sleep.
Okay. You know, I'm a comedian. I say what I mean. Why can't people just say what they mean?
I'm telling you, David, see, this is the thing about poetry. They're well constructed, just like a Jackie Martling joke, you know, except at the end, you don't get the punchline. You get this emotional feeling that, you know, that is the opposite of what I know what it's like to bomb at an open mic. I know it's what it's like to bomb at a mic that's not open, that you're paid and they're expecting you to be funny. I know what that's like, but this is the thing that I love about poem. And if you're a bombing comic, you love poetry because you live for that bomb, which detonates on the inside after you read a stanza or two. It may be blank verse, it may be iambic, you know, pentameter, if you're lucky, it may be something, but at the end, when you read a poem like that 4th of July poem by Elizabeth Knapp, it leaves you with this sense of the silence of those bombs bursting in your heart.
Mm.
It gets you.
Yeah.
And that's a kind of a different, and like I said, it's the poetic side of what the comedians experience when they kill. And
we say what we mean. We don't hide behind meter and homonyms. And speaking of cruelty to animals, let's talk about the Havasupai horses. Who are the Havasupai horses? I understand they're the subject of this week's PETA podcast.
Yeah, well, the Havasupai horses are these horses that are near the Grand Canyon. And you know, that there's a symbolism. You got me talking poetry, David. I have to mention the symbolism of horses and horse abuse. It was really pretty much the rallying cry for animal rights way back with the SPCA and the carriage horses in Central Park. And you're in New York. You know what that's like.
I saw one limping by the other day.
To see the horrible conditions, and then people say, oh, it's so nostalgic to see these horses. And, you know, the thing is, they continue to exist there in New York, and they become replicated in places where, well, the horses were always around. But I was in Nashville about a year ago, and what are they doing in Music City in Nashville with carriage horse rides? Like there's some kind of like sentimental trip down, you know, memory lane with these carriage horses, animal cruelty. Anyway, so I'm just saying that horses are an image or a symbol of animal rights. So there are these Havasupai horses on Indian lands near the Grand Canyon National Park. And they are the pack horses for a trail excursion that charges thousands of dollars to rich people who gladly pay and to have their supplies and their gourmet meals and their alcohol shipped down to the canyon where they can swim and recreate. Well, you know, it means the cruel and unusual treatment of these horses who carry, you know, 40, 60 pounds of equipment on 12 miles of trail in 100 degree heat, and one falls down. And this is an instance that happened. Instead of trying to help the horse up, the horse person with the horse kicked the horse in his face. And we have that horse is named Teardrop, and we have pictures of Teardrop on the podcast notes. And if you go to PETA.org, you can help reform what's happening with the Havasupai horses there, because it's ongoing. There are people there on excursions now. It's something that if you see the pictures and you have a reservation, vaccination, you will cancel them, or you should cancel them, and you should not visit Arizona. And PETA is trying to get the local animal rights group, the Save Havasupai Horses group, and the Bureau of Indian Affairs together to try to stop this. But this is a 40-year thing. And the Native Americans who are part of this deny that there's any cruelty, but the pictures don't lie. And if you see the pictures, you'll see exactly why this is a concern and why people should take action.
Well, before you go, you wrote a piece over at the Asian American Legal Defense and Education Fund. Go ahead.
Yeah, I'm a very well-rounded guy.
You are. So the Supreme Court overturned the Karamatsu decision. What was the Karamatsu decision, and what does it mean now? Are they going to finally let the Japanese out of the internment camps?
No, see, this is the thing that I think confused a lot of people. The Supreme Court did not overturn Korematsu. Nothing I saw indicates that, except Justice Roberts said something. He mentioned Korematsu and said this was the law in 1944. But Sonia Sotomayor, in her dissent, I mean, we're talking about the case that upheld the travel ban 3.0, that the 5-4 majority, terrible decision, but it was upheld. And ironically, Justice Roberts refers to this Korematsu decision. Sonia Sotomayor, in the dissent, also raised it and said, hey, the Korematsu decision was a bad decision. And you know what? We're using this bad decision to uphold another bad decision, the travel ban 3.0. And what people don't understand is, and why there's this confusion, is because back in the 80s, a bunch of young Japanese American lawyers, they fought for Fred T. Korematsu. Fred T. Korematsu in 1944 said he was not going to go to the internment camps. He fought it. His case went all the way up to the Supreme Court. And in 1944, the Supreme Court said, no, because of military necessity, you know. Clear and present danger. You're going to go to these internment camps. He went to the internment camps. He was actually harassed by some Japanese Americans who dutifully went because they saw what the Korematsu was doing was disloyal to America. So there was some conflict there, even among Japanese Americans. But some younger Japanese Americans later in life, in the 80s, said, this Korematsu decision was wrong. We're going to seek justice for Fred Korematsu. They did. They filed in the lower court, and the lower court reversed the decision. But the Supreme Court decision still stood because the U.S. did not appeal. So in the lower court level, Korematsu is overturned. But the Supreme Court decision in 1944, the Korematsu case, still stands. And I asked the lawyer who went to the lower court for Korematsu, why he didn't take it to the Supreme Court. He said, well, look, we didn't take it to the Supreme Court because the U.S. didn't appeal. We figured that no one in their right mind would ever try to use Korematsu as a precedent to do anything like this ever again. What he didn't anticipate Donald T. Trump and a Trump court saying, hey, you know, this Korematsu decision, it's bad, but we're going to do it anyway, because essentially that's what Justice Roberts said. You know, the Korematsu decision is absolutely wrong. And look, it's been overturned. It wasn't overturned in the lower court, but not the higher court. And so Roberts is kind of being hypocritical, where he's saying, hey, look, we don't, you know, there's no logic to Korematsu, but we're going to use it anyway to, you know. There's a clear and present danger currently, and we're going to uphold travel ban 3.0.
Yeah,
and
Fox News, I've seen pundits refer to Korematsu as a justification for the travel ban.
Yeah, of course. They used it, and Sonia Sotomayor picked it up, and in her dissent from the bench, she said, hey, look, how can we say Korematsu, you know, was bad law and then use it to justify this new law? And so this is the state of our justice system because of, this. You know, you gotta point to the administration. You gotta point to how it's, how it goes about its ways in everything, and we are now faced with a court that, you know, the Trump administration will handpick a successor to Anthony Kennedy, who, you know, for many people on the left and progressives was seen as that kind of, you know, he could be a good one. You know, he was seen as more fair than not. You know, he was pro gay marriage and he wrote that decision. I just don't know what's going to happen, except we should be prepared if we don't get legislative majorities to assure fairness. We should expect to see that slow erosion of things that we've come to expect from the 60s. And, you know, just name off the things from the last 50 years that we hold dear to our American society, our values, voting rights, civil rights, affirmative action, unions took a hit last week. So we are talking about a real hard pendulum swing, David.
Yes, sir. Emil Guillermo is the host, well said, is the host of the PETA podcast. It drops every Wednesday. And you can also read him over at the Asian American Legal Defense and Education Fund. We'll talk to you next week, sir.
Thanks, David.
Stay on the line. If you're enjoying today's show, please share it on Facebook, Twitter, StumbleUpon, Dig, Reddit. Copy and paste the link to this show and share it with all your friends via email. Spread the laughs, spread the knowledge, spread the love. Let's go to Long Island, where Jackie the Joke Man is standing by. I don't think you can make me laugh today. It is 100 degrees with the air conditioner on.
So Midget goes up to a girl in the bar. Midget goes up to a girl in the bar. He says, "I got the biggest cock in the world." She says, "You expect me to buy that?" He says, "It's not for sale." So a guy goes to visit his friend at work. He says, "Wow, man, your new secretary is so hot. She's beautiful. She's gorgeous." His friend says, "Yeah, and she's a robot. Squeeze her left boob, she'll take dictation. Squeeze her right boob, she'll dial the boss. And you can fuck her. Go ahead, take her in the closet." So his friend takes her in the closet. All of a sudden he hears, "Ah!" He says, "I forgot to tell you, her asshole's a pencil sharpener." You know why there's 7 pallbearers at a Polish funeral?
Why?
6 to carry the casket and 1 to drag the body.
Let me plug your gig, for Christ's sake. Friday and Saturday, August 3rd through the 4th. You can see Jackie the Joke Man with Lenny Clark. This is too good to be true. In Saugus, Massachusetts, at Giggles Comedy Club. There's nothing better than that. Friday and Saturday, August 3rd through the 4th, with Lenny Clark. Wow.
Great fun. So a black couple gets married.
Yeah.
And it's the honeymoon night, and he takes off his shoes and socks. He's got no toes. She says, "Where's your toes?" He says, "Well, when I was just a boy, I had me some toe main poison, and I lost my toes."
Jesus.
She says, "Oh, So he takes off his pants. He's got no knees. She says, where are your knees? Where is the boy? I had me some pneumonia, and I lost my knees. She says, before you take off your shorts, did you ever have prickly heat? So the judge says to a guy, so it says here that you beat your wife to death with a hammer. And the guy in the back of the courtroom yells, you motherfucker! And the judge says, and it says also that you beat your mother-in-law to death with a hammer. And the guy in the back goes, you cocksucker! Judge says, listen, my friend back there, I know it's a little maddening that this guy could do something so violent, but please stop calling out. And the guy in the back says, for 15 years, I lived next door to him, and every time I tried to borrow a hammer, he told me he didn't have one. So a couple's on their honeymoon, they're driving in the country, and they stop the car and they get out and they're standing there like, leaning on a fence, and there's like six cows and they're all grazing, and all of a sudden a bull comes over the rise, and one at a time he fucks the cows, one, two, fucks all six right in a row. He gets done with the sixth one, he goes back to the first one, he starts fucking them all again. The new bride turns to her new husband and says, you know, it's a shame a man can't perform like that. He says, we could if you let us change cows every time.
Jackie the joke man, follow him.
You know, how you get a girl to make a noise like a dolphin?
How?
You flip her over and try and he goes,
boy, okay.
Little. Did you hear about the girl is a dyslexic bulimic?
No.
After she eats, she sticks two fingers in her asshole.
Jackie the joke man will be
what sits on a wall and has a crack in it?
What?
Humpty.
Oh my god. They're gonna burn the station down. They're gonna burn me down.
How do you ditch a Jewish cop? How do you ditch a Jewish cop?
How?
Drive through a toll booth. So a cannibal and his son are standing there, and all of a sudden there's this beautiful blonde that must have strayed from her camp. And the baby cannibal looks at the blonde and says, hey, Pop, let's take her home and eat her. Father says, fuck you, let's take her home and eat your mother.
Where do you find these?
So a blind guy walks into Macy's, goes out in the middle of the floor, picks up his CNI dog by the tail and starts twirling him over his head. The salesman comes up and says, can I help you? He says, nah, I'm just looking around.
That's just horrible on so many wonderful
The guy
levels.
Calls the mortician and says, hey, you got to bury my wife. The mortician says, I buried your wife 2 years ago. The guy says, well, I got married again. The mortician says, congratulations. So it's late at night and there's a couple out in the meadow, a college couple out in the
meadow. Excuse me for 1 second. Just what? Let me, one minor tweak. Make the mortician Jewish.
from now
right?
on.
Congratulate. Isn't it's better if he's Jewish. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Congratulations. No, he's just mean. He doesn't have to be Jewish. He's just mean.
Okay. I love it anyway. Go ahead.
So a guy goes in to take a leak, and he looks. He's standing next to a black guy, and he looks down, and the black guy's got a white cock. He says, the black guy, I never saw a black guy with a white cock before. He says, I'm not a black guy. He says, I'm a coal miner on my honeymoon. So a guy says to his midget friend, hey, how you doing with that big, big, hot, tall blonde? The midget says, oh, I broke up with her. I had to get rid of her. He says, she was beautiful. Why'd you have to get rid of her? He says, well, when we were nose to nose, my toes were in it. And when we were toes to toes, my nose was in it. And when my cock was in it, I got really fucking lonely. All right, I'm gonna leave you with the greatest one.
All right, let me plug your gigs first.
Go ahead.
Friday and Saturday, August 3rd through the 4th. Go see Jackie the Joke Man at Giggles Comedy Club in Saugus, Massachusetts with the great Lenny Clark. Follow Jackie on Twitter. He posts at least three unbelievably funny jokes at 420 International Marijuana Time. Follow Jackie Martling on Twitter. I'm telling you, Jackie, every day there are like two jokes you post that just
I leap like almost 100 listeners, 100 followers a day. It's really exciting.
You're great. And call 516-922-WINE for the dirty joke line. Use your finger.
Use your finger. So a guy's a down and out musician, not to be redundant. And a friend of his says, look, I'm making a movie. I need some music for my movie. And the guy says, oh, good, man, good. Just send me the movie. He says, listen, you don't have to see the movie. I just need some music, just interstitial music. Send me some music. So the musician sends him some music. And a couple months later, he calls up and says, hey, man, I want to see the movie. I want to see the movie. He says, well, I got to tell you the truth. He says, it's a porn flick. It's a porn movie. And it's only playing in one place down in Greenwich Village, a really seedy place. I don't care, man. I want to go. So he finds out where the theater is. And he goes down. And it's really seedy, seedy. Dumpy theater. And he goes in and sits, and he's the only one in the theater. And then a little old couple comes in, and a little old couple sits a few seats away from him. And all of a sudden the movie starts. 10 seconds into the movie, a guy and a girl, both are on screen. They get naked. They start sucking and fucking. And another 20 seconds in, a Great Dane comes out on the screen. And before you know it, they're fucking the Great Dane. The Great Dane is fucking the woman. The guy is blowing. And the guy is so uptight. He's just so uptight. He turns to the little old couple and he says, this is my music. And the little old lady says, we're here to see our dog.
You make me laugh so hard.
So a woman stand in the lobby of a Miami Beach hotel wearing a full-length fur coat. And the guy comes up and says, lady, you know how many animals had to die for that coat? She says, you know how many animals I had to fuck for this coat?
Right. Jackie the
joke. How can you tell if an auto mechanic just had sex?
How?
One of his fingers is clean.
All right.
Lady says, Doc, kiss me. He's like, can't. She says, come on, Doc, kiss me. He says, ma'am, I can't. She says, Doc, please kiss me. He says, look, lady, I probably shouldn't even be fucking you. You better hang up because I'm not going to stop.
All right. I love you, buddy. Stand the line for 1 second.
Thank you.
The David Feldman Show is available as a podcast for free on iTunes. For a treasure trove of more free stuff, I invite you to check out davidfeldmanshow.com. where you can find podcasts, radio shows, and reading material dating all the way back to 2009, and it's all free. DavidFeldmanShow.com. And while you're over there, I invite you to subscribe to my newsletter.
Let's go to Delaware, where Aaron Berg is standing by on vacation with his family and his mother-in-law. Hello, sir.
It's the first state. You know why they call it that?
Why?
Because you get to put your fingers in it if it goes well.
Wouldn't that make it the third state?
No, the first state, because nowadays they have all the power, the fingers. Even Delaware, it's so America. Have you been here?
The Delaware Water Gap is one of the prettiest stretches of road in America.
Yeah, it's a nice stretch of road, but you got to go into the heartland where the Blue Lives Matter flags fly every house. I'm telling you, there's so many. I went to a trailer park yesterday to do sex on my cousin, and there's Blue Lives Matter flags everywhere. They love, they're big fans of the law here. They did not legalize weed. They were up all the other night fighting it, and that was the thing. They were fighting that and the minimum wage thing here in Delaware. Those are the two major sticking points, are the weed and the minimum wage. That's where they're at politically. But other than that, lovely place. I was on the water. They have a thing called an ocean nearby here. Mm. Have you heard of it? And you go swimming, and the salt water gets you all sticky. And then it's lovely. I sit outside. I smoke cigars. My wife argues more because she's trying to impress her family, you know? You know when they do that? And she's like, blah, blah, blah. And she'll say stuff like this one. You know when people are too familiar and they'll point and she'll talk to someone else about their husband. They'll be like, oh, he's great. He always puts a baby to sleep. And she'll look all side-eyed and go, well, this one, you know what he does? He goes out and does his skits until all hours of the night, comes home gallivanting around, throwing the checkbook at the bills. It's lovely.
One of the benefits of living in L.A., it's a company town. You don't have to explain what you do for a living. Do you have to explain what you do for a living to your in-laws?
What I do is we, here in Delaware, you drive by and you'll see a burning cross. And then what I do is I go, you see what they're doing? And they go, yeah. And I go, I make jokes about that. And they're like, specifically? And I go, let's get out of here. They can smell the Jew. And then we drive. Something smells like not bacon. That's all you know. Smells like not bacon. I don't have to explain. My wife's a comic too, so it's getting very competitive where I'm very happy that she's starting to get some work because of quotas. But, you know, she's starting to get some work, which makes me happy. But now she thinks she's funnier than me, which is an awkward thing because I'll make a joke and someone will laugh and she goes, that's not funny. And I go, no, someone laughed, which means it's funny. Whereas when you do it and you giggle at it by yourself and then write it down and go work on this, that's not funny. So
do you ever come up with bits in the car and then fight over whose is whose and which is which?
I just bully them. No, she usually takes, she's kind of greedy like that. She'll just take them right away. She had this thing where her Jesus candle fell on my head and burnt. She bought a Jesus candle like she's some Brazilian that just escaped the wall. And she bought it, and I go looking for Q-tips, and the Jesus candle fell on me, and she's like, I'm going to make that about me. And I was like, I was a victim. You don't get to make Holocaust jokes because your people holocausted mine. I don't know if that's a verb. Oh, by the way, let me say this very briefly. As you know, several months ago, I did a show called White Guys Matter, and people are still upset about it. And one of the front runners, in terms of people being upset about it, said, you know, he's a Jew. If I would do a show called What Holocaust, he would be really upset. And first of all, I'm like, no, I wouldn't. And second of all, I'm like, how do we get that to Broadway? That's a wonderful show. What Holocaust? What happened? Gally has any malpractice?
prove it. What Holocaust? That one? No, this one. No, that one? No, this one. No such thing as a Holocaust. They made it up just to open law firms. No Holocaust is the best Holocaust. What Holocaust? Not Holocaust? No, not nuts. I'm allergic. What Holocaust? That's what I said. But Holocaust? No, please, I'm not gay. Soot Holocaust? I'm not a chimney. What Holocaust? Hey, hey, hey. What Holocaust? Songs by Lin-Manuel Miranda. Holocaust, Holocaust, let me Holocaust, 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 let me Holocaust. With an all-black cast. What Holocaust? Coming to Broadway from the people that brought you Hamilton and Get Out. It's What Holocaust? Lyrics by Key Jordan Peele and Lin-Manuel Miranda. With special appearances by Reverend Al Sharpton. I lost most of my face in the early 2000s. I had a lappendectomy, but I can't solve the Harlem problem. Ooh, I am skinny. Reverend Al Sharpton's daughter. Y'all police pulling me over. I didn't do nothing except run over a lady.
All right. Is that true? Al Sharpton's daughter?
she did something bad. There was some guy. She didn't remember. Caitlyn Jenner ran over a lady. What Holocaust? It's theater week in New York. Get your What Holocaust tickets for $9.99 or 1881, which is a Nazi sign. What Holocaust? Bring your SS down and sit in the front row of the orchestra. What Holocaust? Where's my fillings? I don't know. Whoops, I left them over there. What Holocaust? Is Switzerland gonna help us? What Holocaust?
So you're saying that you wouldn't be offended by
I'm a comic. I don't get offended by anything. Look, here's something that offended me. Someone said something. I posted a picture of my daughter online, and someone said something really cruel about my lovely daughter. And for a moment, I was offended. And then I realized, oh, that's the nature of what people do, is they're trying to get a reaction out of me. So, you know, when it's your child, I think you get offended. My wife, I don't care, you know. You can make fun of my wife. I don't care. People make fun of her. I'm like, yeah, I'm with this guy. I sometimes go and stand over with them when they're making fun of her. And she's like, whose side are you on? And I'm like, well, clearly, judging by the physicality, this guy.
Well, as our listeners know, you're from Canada, and Justin Trudeau is in some hot water, right?
Oh, no. What? I have not been reading the news because I'm in Delaware, so I didn't see what happened. What happened?
He's been accused of groping a reporter in the year 2000. The Guardian and CBC report that in 2000, then 28-year-old Justin Trudeau, as a teacher, groped a reporter.
I'm going to say this. First of all, in the year 2000, groping was not what it is now. Groping was considered legal and beneficial to both sexes. It helped people get ahead in the business. It was an outlet for additional testosterone. 2015 is when this came up, this whole, he groped me. Back then, groping was foreplay. Groping was a way of getting to know one another.
Getting to grope you.
Getting to grope everything about your back door. Not grabbing the front door. I need to work slowly and take down your buttons and kiss your neck. Getting to grope you. Whoopsie, I just grazed a breast or two.
Okay, all right, all right. We can't. Yeah. Okay, so according to Valerie Bourne, she's...
Liar. Liar. I don't even know who she is right away. That name, liar. You know how I'll believe it, David? If she has one of his fake eyebrows on her pillowcase. he can't do this. He's a liberal hero in Canada. He is their equivalent of a president, but with no power. He is the prime minister. He thinks Vito is a guy that sold him a souvlaki. He thinks an executive order is what he makes when he gets a steak from Ruth's Chris. He thinks past administration is something that had to do with going to detention. I had nothing for that.
Well, he's apologized. He said if he had known that this was a reporter for a national paper, I never would have been so forward.
Anyway. But if she worked for a high school paper, by all means.
Do we like Justin Trudeau? Are you proud of him?
Look, do I think he's a little... I think he hedges his bets. I think he plays all sides of the fence. I think he's important to Canada. I think he is what Canada deserves as a leader, much as your president is the president that America deserves as a leader. I think that there's changes coming to Canada. I think that the pendulum will shift. But I still think, you know, yesterday was Canada Day. I celebrated by burning a Canadian flag underneath an American flag while playing Colin Kaepernick practice footage.
What is Canada Day?
Canada Day is 3 days before the 4th of July, when they celebrate their independence from nothing. They are dependent upon every other country except for nickel, wood, and water. So if you could live on those three things and trout and badger blood, then you would be okay. But because they can't, they are dependent on everybody. So they're not really independent. I think they became independent from the... I don't know what it is. I mean, I left Canada for a reason.
They're still part of the Commonwealth, so they're not completely independent.
No, they're part of the Commonwealth. That's why the Queen is on their money, and Prince Harry is on the $5 bill dressed as a Nazi.
What does July 4th mean to you? As a naturalized citizen of the United States, what does it mean to be an American citizen?
I'm not technically a citizen yet.
Oh, you're not?
Right now, I am... Right now, I am what they call separated from my family and staying in a camp. That's what they call me, but the camp is New York City. I've become a citizen in 3 years.
Did you have to take a test?
My vote matters. Did you know that?
Wait a second. So you're not an American citizen, so I can call ICE on you.
I am a permanent resident.
What does that mean?
It means you can't. Because I'm white.
You can't what?
You can't call ICE on me because I'm white.
Permanent. I thought the minute you marry one of our women's, you become a citizen.
Yeah, technically. I just have to fill out and pay the...
You have to do what?
Fill out the paperwork and pay the $80.
Okay. Is it worth $80 to become an American citizen?
I think it's the greatest country on the planet Earth, in this country and in North America. Hands down. It's all 38 states have my respect. I've garnered them.
All 38?
I pledge allegiance to the King of America and the 32 states on which we stand. 4th of July is very important to me because it's a very divisive day right now. 4th of July becomes, because when you say that you love America, some people get upset. And then also my wife will explain sometimes, she'll go, it's very American to dislike the government. Nothing is more American than that. She goes, blind patriotism is not an American value, which I would agree with. I think that you have to give this some thought.
Well, I think you define your patriotism by the love of the government, not the current government, but a love for government. That's what the country is. The Constitution, the contract that we have, that we observe among ourselves to treat each other judiciously. That's my patriotism. I feel like the right, they wave the American flag, but they hate Washington, D.C. They hate government. If you don't...
Yeah, they want smaller government. They want less people involved. And libertarians, too, right?
Yeah, they hate the government. They hate what this country stands for.
If you hate the government, you hate what this country stands for.
Right.
I think.
So my wife is wrong.
Well, automatically she's wrong.
I was outside last night and I had swim trunks on and alcohol-free beer, and I was waving a flag, said, and I was yelling, take it from my cold, dead hands. And everybody just kept driving. And she goes, that's not patriotism. And I said, what is? And she goes, signing this bill.
Paying for this bill, you mean?
Yeah. And I go, no, no, that's a check that you've made out to cash, and you're asking me to sign it. Yeah. It's interesting to me what becomes, I mean, I love America because of the opportunities it's given me, and because the great people in my life, and because of the ability that, I don't know if it's a governmental thing, it's not a geographical thing, I think it's because of the businesses here. But, you know, I really felt like my dreams came true when I moved to this country, and I never felt that in Canada. I always felt like I was struggling, and it was always an uphill battle.
Your dreams came true in America, and they can't come true in Canada?
They weren't, and I was there for, you know, the better part of my life. I was there for 37 years.
What, if you had stayed in Canada, how high could you get in comedy? I would think you could go to England, you could travel throughout the Commonwealth.
Yeah, you could go to England. A lot of people did that, but it's, you know, there's a couple guys that make it. There's a couple guys, for the most part, you have to be clean. You have to play by the rules. For my style of comedy, I wouldn't have been able to find an audience in Canada. I maybe would have had, you know, five strong supporters that would come out to coffee shops every time I went and talked about my wiener. But it's like, in America, just because of the population, if you're doing something different and you're good at it, people will be drawn to it. And you don't need to go the mainstream route.
Okay.
Those are my thoughts on it.
But that's always been the case in Canada. There's always been a ceiling for comics
who
felt they had to come and marry our women. Mm-hmm. Now, if you divorce this woman.
Whoa, you just got me hard. Keep talking.
Do you keep your American citizenship?
Yeah, sure. I'm already in. I got a baby. El baby de anchor is what they call it. My Spanish isn't that good, but it's El Nino de Anchor, I believe. The Sombrero de Lawbreaker. I don't know what it's called, but I got a baby. You're going to separate me from my baby? America would never do that, separate someone from their child.
Has ICE ever knocked on your door? You're an
Let me tell you, David. The other day, there was a march to bring families together in New York. I'm not sure if you went. But I went with ICE, and I would just point out people that I thought. And I was like, that guy.
No.
Check it. And they were like, They're like the new SWAT, ICE. They have the coolest name. They have a drug named after them, which is high-end meth called ICE. Do you remember? There was a big infestation in Hawaii years ago, which led to Dog the Bounty Hunter becoming so successful because he was chasing down people with ICE and making them find Jesus. And he'd be like, bro, you got a family. You got to take care of them. They're like, I know. I'm going to get better. Next thing you know, they're sucking cock outside Oahu trying to get $6 to fix.
But as a white Canadian who came to America, do you feel persecuted? Do you feel any threat?
No. So ICE just showed up. No, I don't feel any threat that I'm going to, you know, I did everything legally. I spent tens of thousands of dollars. It took me years to move here. I paid my coyote in hand job. He's like, I was like, thanks for getting me here. He's like, you didn't really need me. I was like, hey.
Did it cost you tens of thousands of dollars to come to America?
Yeah. I had to get two O-1 visas and then I had to get a green card. Tens of thousands.
We don't make it easy to come to America.
No, you don't. But, I mean, there's other... Canada, I think, is easy to get into. There's, you don't... I don't know. What do you think? I mean, do you really want open borders? And if so, is the stuff that I read propaganda? When I read what's happening in Europe and you'll hear about all these horrible incidences, is it propaganda? Is it, you know, a very small amount of people? I read a story today that had nothing to really do with illegal immigration. There was 9 people stabbed in Ohio. And then they just happen to throw in at a place where refugees are staying. And so automatically it makes you think, oh, these are bad people. And I don't think that's necessarily true. The guy that delivers me my pizza seems like a lovely guy. Sometimes he rings and I answer it and I go, ice. And then he just eats the pizza and runs off.
There's no immigration problem. We don't have open borders. The number of people coming from South America is down. It's an all. And it's the lowest point it's been in 40 years. Fewer and fewer people are coming to America through the South. There's been a surge of mothers and children coming from Guatemala, Honduras, and Nicaragua.
Yeah.
Because of gang problems and violence. But the numbers are down. There's no immigration problem. There really isn't. It's a political issue. It's a political football. They're being hired. The ones who are allegedly taking work away from Americans are being hired by factories and slaughterhouses. I don't see ICE kicking down those doors and arresting the white men who are hiring these undocumented workers.
Right. I also heard this. I heard there's a reverse Mexico problem, that more people have left to go back to Mexico than have come in. But let me also ask you this. I have heard that Democratic people try to get illegal people into the country to vote for them. Now, is that a real thing or is that just a made-up thing?
That's made up.
That's made up because you got to teach them the language. You got to get them to register. That's like that's a 10 to 12 year long-term plan. No one's doing that.
And yet you have to be a citizen to vote.
Technically.
There's no evidence of voter fraud in America.
I voted 18 times.
that was the People's Choice Award.
for Cynthia Nixon to be the new governor of New York. Because I'm a Miranda. You know what I'm saying?
You know, I took that test. Which character are you from Sex and the City? I'm a chlamydia.
Yeah, that was a great character. She was in episodes 4 through 18 and gave Carrie quite a lot of problems until she got some cranberry martinis.
Do you watch Sex and the City? Does your wife watch Sex and the City? I am amazed. Women love Sex and the City.
Yeah, and Sex in the Farm. I've given them that as well. And Sex in the Butthole on birthdays.
Did you ever watch Sex and the City?
Yeah, I watched Sex and the City.
Do you enjoy it? Do you understand it?
I understood it. You know, I get, you know, I was a male stripper, so I get gay stuff. So it's like, yeah, I had no problem with it. I thought it was a good show. I think the lead in that, Seabiscuit, he was fantastic.
You can't do that.
I think after that series, he would have been exhausted, but still won the Belmont Stakes this year. And I think that's phenomenal.
So you're saying that Cynthia Nixon shouldn't be running for governor since it's a political horse race. It should be Sarah Jessica Parker.
Sarah Jessica Parker would clearly win in New York. She's an avid New Yorker.
She would be the dark horse face, is what you're saying.
Yeah, and she has she could do a wonderful time around the gubernatorial lap, if you will.
Are you saying she's champing at the bit to run for governor? Is that what you're saying?
I think the sweetest thing for her would be a sugar cube and a little cut up apple. And you just nuzzle it into your hand and you go, who's a good runner? Who's a good runner? Who's married to Matthew Broderick?
Be nice.
She's married to Matthew Broderick.
Had he been riding her instead of that car in Ireland, those kids would still be alive.
He killed kids in Ireland? I didn't know this.
It was a car accident. Oh, I'm going to die. What's wrong with me, sir? It's hot. And it's the July 4th weekend coming up in the middle.
Yeah.
In the middle.
That seems very, I only a president like our president could schedule it. So you get a full week off to celebrate a day.
Yeah. Yeah, freedom. It is precious. It is precious.
It ain't free, I'll tell you that much. Okay, I think I found a cabin, by the way.
You did?
I think so. I found it online. The past owners were Canadian. They're flying a big Canadian flag. It's two bedroom, one bathroom, plus a sleeping loft. So lots of room for you and your lady friends with beards and pectoral muscles. you know, yeah. Just a fishing weekend with lots of fun times and ouchy butt. I think I'm going to put an offer on it. It comes with a boat slip, too. So I'll buy the place, I get a little boat, and then boom, we're out.
You sent me some pictures. They looked really intriguing up in the Catskills, right?
Let me ask you this. Are they too working class? I don't want to go to a place where it's too, where, you know, because I look like an asshole. I have tattoos and big muscles, but I don't want everyone to look like me. I want people to look at me and be like, oh, that guy's the asshole. I don't want to see other people like me and look at them and be like, oh, that's an asshole. Hang on, we're just trying to get this dog ready to cook. It doesn't want to go in the pot. I know, but we got the carrots and celery ready. We got to do this.
No. When they say hot dogs in America, it's a term for a type of food. It's a sausage.
Are you sure?
Yeah, positive.
Fourth of July. I heard you have hot dogs. He won't jump in the fire.
Whose doggy is that?
We found him by the roadside. We were going to split him evenly. Hang on. Let me see here.
Oh, what kind of doggy is that?
That is a Bichon Frise. There you go, dog. Go inside. Go. Go. Go inside. Get in the pot. There we go. Nice and silent. Come on. Oh, one more dog here. Go. There we go, buddy. Go. Oh, another dog. Okay, there we go. Dogs are done. Dinner's ready in five. All right.
Hold them. Before you go, tell me about the cabin because you sent me some pictures. It doesn't matter who the neighbors are as long as they're quiet.
Do you think they'll be quiet? I heard in the Poconos there's a lot of rooskies. You know what those are?
I've heard horror stories about people from the Bronx moving to the Poconos.
Yeah.
And it ain't pretty.
Like, what type of stories?
Just people from the Bronx who bring their New York attitude to the woods.
I don't want that.
Me neither. I want it quiet. I don't want to hear music. When I'm in the woods, I want to be just me and the bears.
Yeah, that's it. And then once those gay dudes are done, then you just want nature around. But it's like, I'm wondering, they must have some kind of policing or something. There must be, like, if the music's too loud after 11, maybe some old guy in a golf cart drives around and he's like, could you turn that down? I killed 14 Koreans.
Now, is it true you called the police last night because there was a black person on your television?
No, that was the night. I looked out the window and I was frightened and I was like, ah, what's all this black? And then my wife goes, that's the night. And I go, oh, I thought it was a purge. Okay. Got very scared. Racism is not a good thing, and I am fighting against it.
Yes, and your new schedule. Tell us about your new schedule and how people can follow you.
Oh, Mondays to Thursdays, I'll be on compoundmedia.com every morning at 9, bringing shock media back to New York City. It'll be very exciting. And I'll be doing stand-up. I'm going to do a lot less stand-up because I have perfected the art form.
Yes, so you have. You're a great stand-up.
I'm going to... No, I can't do less. I feel like I want to do less. But the plan now is I'll be doing Monday to Thursday at Compound Media. And then every Thursday afternoon, I'm going to leave and go up to the cabin. Rain or shine, winter or summer. And then maybe one or two weekends out of the month, I'll stay in the city and do stand-up, or I'll go on the road and do stand-up. Great. That's it. I'm going to Washington, by the way. You would love it there. You got to work this club. Parlor Live. You ever been there?
Is this D.C. or state?
Bellevue, Washington.
Oh, I love Bellevue.
Is it nice?
Beautiful. Beautiful.
Okay. I'm doing that in Vancouver. You would love it. Maybe I could see if I could get more money and we could go together and then do like a yin and yang thing. Like you would go up and then someone funny would go. So we would work it, you know, just to mix the show up. we mix it up. You know, we have like a little like, hey, maybe some of you guys like TED Talks about lesbianism and divorce. And then people will be like, yeah, all right. And then we'll have like a break where people can go throw up and punch the palate. And then I'll go.
Fantastic. How do people follow you on Twitter, sir?
At Aaron Berg Comedy on Twitter. And my new show, obviously, coming out off-Broadway. We're going to be running it, and it'll be in Connecticut, called What Holocaust? produced by David Feldman and Aaron Berg. Funding by the German National Board for Re-Education on the Holocaust. So come out and check it out. It's a feel-good musical. And choreography by Tom Hanks at the end of Philadelphia.
Yeah. 6 million people can be wrong. That's going to be the tagline.
That's the tagline. I love this show. Can we do it? I want to do it as a fringe show. Can we just do a New York fringe called What Holocaust? David Feldman and Aaron Berg. I will do it. I'm going to fill out the fringe paperwork. We're doing it next year. Guys, stay tuned for What Holocaust, brought to you by David Feldman and Aaron Berg with an all-black cast. Okay? An all-black, I want an all-black gay cast in What Holocaust. Starring Chadwick LaShania and Esther Rosenberg.
We're in the
DeAndre Watkins. DeAndre Watkins as Saul, the first visitor to Auschwitz, Leibowitz.
Tell me Yo, about the war so
Auschwitz ghetto. Looking weird. Auschwitz. Okay. More like Auschwitz. Back off for me. I don't want to ride the train. I don't even trust the train. Where's this train going? I don't want to take a shower. Why would you make me take a shower? I'm not even schwitzing. Something smells like gas, and it's not my wife's skin. All right,
you're actually offending me now.
I love it. Let's do this show. We'll talk. I'm gonna.
You know what? I think it should focus on the Warsaw Ghetto.
Okay.
I think that would be more interesting.
As the snow flies on a cold and gray Chicago morning, and a little baby child is born, Warsaw Ghetto. Warsaw Ghetto. And his mama cries, because if there's one thing she don't need, it's another little Jewy mouth to feed. Warsaw Ghetto. Warsaw Ghetto.
All right. I love you. Stay on the line for 1 second. You're enjoying today's show, please remember to do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com, hit the Amazon banner, click on it, and then shop away. We get a small percentage of everything you purchase. I promise you, every penny we get goes towards keeping the show going. And if you're doing your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website, hit the contact button, let me know so I can thank you.